Good morning and a warm welcome to the 17th meeting of the Constitution Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee in 2022. We've received apologies from Maurice Gold this morning and a welcome to committee. Graeme says as his substitute and invite Mr Simpson to make any relevant interests to declaration.
Thanks, Convener. I've got no relevant interest to declare.
Thank you. Move to agenda item 1, the decision to take business in private. Are members content to take agenda item 4 in private?
Yes.
Thank you very much. I'm now going to move to our second agenda item, which we have two panels from Channel 4 this morning. And can I first of all welcome John McVeigh, Chief Executive Officer, Producer Alliance for Cinema and Television, Nicole Cleeman, Managing Director of Firecast Films, and David Smith, Director of Screen Scotland. And a warm welcome to you all virtually this morning. If I could open with a question perhaps directed at Mr. Smith, in how you would describe the working relationship at the moment between Channel 4 and Screen Scotland, and can you give us any update of the memorandum of understanding between the two organisations?
Good morning. Thank you for inviting me in today. We have a very close working relationship with Channel 4, both within the Scotland team, based at the Hub in Glasgow, and in Horseferry Road, and nationally with the base in Leeds as well. We have not yet signed an MOU with Channel 4. That's not stopped us from progressing lots of collaborative work with them. We've recently had a daytime co-development project. We've just launched an initiative based around entertainment production for Christmas 2022, where we've worked with Channel 4 to secure a specific slot for a new pilot on the Christmas schedule, a new pilot for an entertainment format within the Christmas schedule that we'll jointly develop with them and with companies based in the Scotland sector. That directly feeds into our work at Kelvin Hall and the redevelopment of the central vault within Kelvin Hall as a television entertainment studio. Entertainment is an area where Scotland-based producers have real capacity for growth. We've recognised that. We've with the Scottish Government, Glasgow City Council, we've developed that space within Kelvin Hall as a what's known as a shiny floor show stage. It's not a film studio in the normal sense. It's very much a television entertainment studio. It's almost an exact copy of Television Centre 1 in London, where Graham Norton and various other shows are filmed every week. So it's a really useful space that augments our capacity already existing across Scotland, including PQ, where we have two entertainment studios already. So it's a collaborative approach. It's a strategic approach. One of the things we often say with things in Screen Scotland is, you know, essentially everything's connected. You have to join up all of the right parts at the right time. And we feel we're doing that on multiple fronts. Channel 4 are one of our closest collaborators. We work very well with them, and I think their work with the Scottish sector over the last 5 years in particular has been fantastic. We've really grown their supplier base. They've really expanded the range of programming that they're making from Scotland, and it is from Scotland. You know, we're seeing real Scottish representation on screen. Nicole can speak for herself, but I think the Rescue series is a fantastic example of that, a project that we co-invested in alongside Channel 4, which really represents modern Scotland on screens across the UK.
If I could push a little bit on that and then ask a more general question to the rest of the panel. If the plans go ahead as detailed by the Westminster government at the moment, how do you see that relationship changing and what would be your concerns about it?
It 100% depends on who buys it, but our concerns are major. I think at the moment we have a very functional publicly owned public service broadcasting sector across the UK. The publicly owned PSBs are the BBC and Channel 4. We've just published an economic value report this morning for Screen in Scotland. It's the first time that level of detail has been delivered about the sector, and the role that the public service broadcasters play in our creative economy is really central. Between them, the BBC and Channel 4 account for 87% of all public service broadcaster spend in Scotland. Channel 4, from memory, is 12% of that figure. By comparison, ITV, which is one of the likely buyers for Channel 4, is less than 1%. Now, obviously, ITV would argue that they have STV in Scotland, but their footprint is a UK-wide footprint. The STV service is an opt-out service within the Channel 3 overall licence. And for one of our national broadcasters, public service broadcasters, not to play a bigger part in our national conversation not to represent Scotland across the rest of the UK, I think, is a lack. Now, ITV are one of likely buyers. They're not the only likely buyer. But the model of their behaviour is they tend to commission the majority of their content in-house from companies that they themselves own, and mostly within England. Channel 4 doesn't do that. It's a publisher broadcaster. So it is the cornerstone, along with the BBC, of our creative economy in Scotland. It's absolutely the cornerstone of the independent production sector across the whole of the UK. Now, anything that I think the white paper proposal is that it will stop becoming a publisher broadcaster, that the independent quota of 25% will be maintained, but that's across the whole of the UK. I can't remember if the white paper says anything about the nations and regions quotas, but I suspect that they would also be at threat. Now, quotas may feel, I don't know, like a bit of a blunt instrument, but they genuinely work. Broadcasters work to quotas, and in Channel 4's case, they work above and beyond the quotas. So there is no evidence to suggest that a sale of Channel 4 to a private buyer will be good for Scotland, will be good for the independent production sector across the UK, will deliver anything positive to the Levelling Up agenda, and plenty of reasons to be concerned on all of those fronts. I think it's... I'm keen to see what the evidence is that this is a good idea. I read a piece in The Times the other day from a colleague, David Strachan, who used to run Turn Television in Aberdeen and Glasgow. And his description of it, I think, was quite telling. Essentially, what the UK government is proposing is that we remove the commercial relationship between Channel 4 and the independent production sector, and we replace it with a system of grants that will level up in some way across the UK. That doesn't feel like a very conservative approach. It doesn't feel like a very... It feels like a solution in search of a problem, really.
Thank you. And for Ms Cleeman and Ms McVeigh, I'll go to Ms Cleeman first. What would you see as the major threats, and also are there opportunities in what's proposed in the white paper at the moment?
I'm gravely concerned, having read the white paper, for many reasons. The first thing is that I think we all think of Channel 4 as a broadcaster, but Channel 4 is also an incubator. It's an incubator of businesses like ours. Channel 4 recycles the profit that it makes into companies like us, supercharging our growth. When Channel 4 invested in our company, Firecrest Films, in 2017, tripled our turnover in the first year. And we've seen steady growth ever since. We employ 65 people from our office in Govan. We've made it through the pandemic, and we carried all our employees through the pandemic. And Channel 4 has been there for us at every stage of our growth. Channel 4 was the reason that the company started. Channel 4 allowed us to expand into current affairs. Channel 4 then gave us extra grants to encourage us to diversify. And we won a returning series called Super Shoppers, which ran for 8 series, providing long-term stability in the company, and allowing us to grow further. Channel 4 gave us then another grant through their Alpha Fund to diversify out of current affairs. And we started developing documentaries. Our first documentary commission was with Channel 4, which was with access to the Scottish Prison Service. It was the first time a documentary like that had been made up here, and it showcased the very different way the Scottish Prison Service was running to the rest of the UK and beyond. We had international sales on that series, showcasing, as David said, about another series of ours. Channel 4 showcasing modern Scotland to the rest of the UK and to the world. Then Channel 4 took an investment stake in the business, and the business has been hugely successful since then. The kind of growth and success we would never have dreamed of. So Channel 4 has been there at every stage of our growth, and no other broadcaster does that. So Channel 4 has a very, very special place in terms of boosting the screen economy in Scotland. And apart from company investment, they invest in us in skills and in talent, growing the talent base here. There aren't many documentary companies in Scotland, and so we didn't have an enormous talent pool to fish from when we started. And Channel 4 has helped grow that talent base at every level, from new entrants to senior talent. The other reason to be concerned is that the white paper set out in-house production at Channel 4. Now, at the moment, Channel 4 gets 100% of its production from independent production companies like us. The white paper says that 75% of production will go in-house to Channel 4, so then there'll only be a window of 25% for companies like us, and that's companies across the UK. So that can hardly have a positive effect on the sector in Scotland. I can't see any positives from privatisation. I'm trying to because I'm an optimistic person and I'm looking to the future, but I really can't see any benefits. What I can see is that it's going to be very difficult for other people to do what we've done at Firecrest and to follow us, because that drawbridge is going to be pulled up.
Thank you. Mr. McVie?
Good morning, and thank you for inviting me to give evidence today. I think Nicole and David have touched on many of the key issues. I mean, let's be clear, the Westminster government has taken a wrecking ball to the successful British independent production sector, which is currently a 3.2 billion economy, both domestic production and international production from sales and formats. We've done some impact analysis, unlike the Westminster government, who has done no impact analysis or published anything that's credible. We estimate over the next 10 years, if the sale of Channel 4 is to go ahead, that it's a loss of £4.2 billion for the British independent production sector. And obviously, that means a massive impact on the Scottish independent sector. And that's a loss of direct revenues and indirect revenues from secondary sales. This is a transfer of value from hundreds of entrepreneurial companies like Nicole's to whoever buys Channel 4. They will own the programming, they will own the IP, and if that is an American owner, that is a direct transfer of money and British intellectual property and Scottish intellectual property to the new owners. So this is a disaster for the independent production sector if it's to go ahead. This will not only be a direct impact on Nicole's company, this will be an impact on the next company who thinks that they would like to set up a production business in Scotland, because those opportunities will be diminished. Channel 4 is the key incubator for people entering into the British production and broadcasting sector, and that will be lost under the government's current proposals.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. McVie. We're now going to open to questions from the committee, and I move first to Mr. Ruskell, who's joining us online.
Thanks, Convener. Pretty sobering thoughts from the panel already, but can I turn to the international work, particularly that Screen Scotland does? Hopefully we're going to see some increased investment to Screen Scotland for its international engagement work. How would the privatisation of Channel 4 affect that?
You go to Mr. Smith.
Muted. There we go. Sorry, my microphone was muted there briefly. The international work's a key component of our development of the sector over the next 10 years. The economic value report we published this morning recognises a kind of value, a gross value-added impact for the Scottish economy of screen in all of its forms of around £550 million. Previous reports have indicated that the production, they've mostly been a kind of production for film and high-end television drama, and they've indicated a figure roughly under £100 million. I joined from the sector in 2019. I used to run a production company in Glasgow, and I was really conscious that a large chunk of the work that we produced was never counted as part of the previous survey. It's a valid survey; it continues because it's a historic reference point. But we needed to have something that showed that screen is not a singular creative industry, it's a whole range of creative industries, including film. And I think one of the things where we work very close, one of the areas where we work very closely with Channel 4 is in Film 4. When I joined Screen Scotland in 2019, we had just the filming of a film called Limbo had just completed. It went on to screen as part of the Cannes programme in 2021. I'm going to say it might be in 2020. That international reach for those films is only really possible in collaboration with Film 4 or BBC Film and the BFI. Independent film from Scotland is a core component of our work, a core component of our international outreach, our cultural representation, but also how we develop a sector of potential winners in the future. Douglas McKinnon, who made Good Omens and Anansi Boys, was an independent filmmaker once upon a time in Sky. He's grown to become a kind of an industry figure who can land multiple parts, multiple series for production within Scotland. I'm not going to say that every independent filmmaker has that trajectory, but you have to grow talent you have to work in collaboration with companies like Film4, like BBC Film, to develop international film. And that's a reputational building thing that adds into the whole economic argument. So we want to see economic growth. We want to see international development. And that's in two directions. I'll come back to that in a second. That's both incoming and outgoing. But we also want to see cultural growth. And we want to see films and filmmakers from Scotland, programmakers from Scotland, winning international business. So that very much means Film4 and film. It also means Channel 4. When Channel 4 invests in a company like Nicole's and buys a programme from them, it's a kite mark. It's a quality standard that's put against that programme. It means it's of great attractive. It has real value in the international market. It's very attractive. It indicates that it's been made to a high standard. That's crucial because it means that we, as the UK as a whole, has a competitive advantage because of the strength of our public service broadcasters and the work they do with the independent production sector. But to answer your question, kind of going back briefly to the international point, our strategy over the next 10 years is to grow the gross value added impact of Sweden and Scotland from roughly 550 million to roughly 1 billion. That's only going to be possible with significant growth in or continued investment in skills and growth in infrastructure. That will deliver international outreach, that will deliver inward investment productions. Channel 4 has a role to play in both of those.
Thanks. Just before you come back in, Mark, could I maybe push you on the situation where you were doing production in Scotland, but it wasn't counted? Could you explain a bit about that? I'm struggling to understand what an example of what that would be.
This kind of really focused on film, what's called high-end television drama. So you're talking about drama that's worth more than £1 million an hour in terms of production costs. The majority of production activity in Scotland wasn't captured by that count because it was below that figure. All day in day out television production, all factual production, all entertainment production, more or less, was missed from previous counts because it wasn't. It didn't breach through that tax barrier of £1 million per hour for drama, and it wasn't a film. Now that figure, that count was valid. It did show what Sweden, Scotland and its predecessors was focused on at that point in time, which was growth in film and high-end television drama. But Sweden, Scotland, as it was reformed in 2018 and going forward from that point, has a much broader reach. We're interested in all forms of production across film and television. We're interested in the business of broadcasting from Scotland, cinema and film exhibition, skills and infrastructure development, education. They're all part of our brief. So this new study is a much more full-spectrum study.
And thank you for mentioning it. I haven't been able to take it on board yet, but it was on GMS this morning, the production of the report, which sounds really interesting. So thank you. And apologies, I'll bring Mr. Ruskell back in.
No, that's fine. Nicole, can I ask for your reflections on the international work?
Of course. The international part of our business is becoming more and more important. That is the intellectual property, the IP that we retain. When we make programmes for Channel 4 or for the BBC, we're allowed to keep the IP of those programmes. And that's really important for us because then when we go on to sell international distribution, as David says, having made programmes for a broadcaster like the BBC or Channel 4, that's worth a lot in the international market because of the premium quality that international buyers know that will have. When we sell those programmes abroad, we can then use the profits from that to reinvest back into our business and into our staff and into developing future projects. The problems that we've had over the last few years mean that it's very, very difficult now for our business to make any margin on production at all. So when we make a programme here for the BBC or for Channel 4, we more or less break even on the production costs. It's very, very difficult to make any margin. And so the profit that the business generates that pays for the development of us thinking up new programmes in the future all comes from our international sales. It's really critical for us that we retain IP and that we have international sales. That's the only way the business can grow.
So what would the impact of privatisation be in terms of those international sales then?
Well, it's difficult to know because it's difficult to know without knowing who the buyer of Channel 4 would be. My reading of it is that we would have much fewer opportunities to make programmes for Channel 4 because they're going to take 75% of production in-house. So we'll then be limited by who our customers are. And although it's good business to have business with streamers, streamers like Netflix and Amazon, they retain IP, because when you make a program for them, they put it across their platforms internationally. So we don't have that. So we have to make sure that we do a good deal with them at the start so that we're compensated for the IP. But it would be a risky business if you only made for companies and where you gave up your IP at the point of commission.
Yeah, thanks. And John?
Yes, well, over the past 15 years or so, thanks to the fact that since 2003, British independent producers have legally been able to own the copyright in the programmes they make for the public service broadcasters, we've seen a boom in international activity. Over half of the revenues for the independent sector in the UK comes from international activity. There's three components to that. One is sales, as Nicole has just talked about, in terms of selling programmes, and it's vitally important that you can get sales because, as Nicole has said, that is often your margin. That's called your back end. That's where you generate revenues from selling the programme. Or it's selling the intellectual property, so format rights, you know, which is like reality programming or game shows, which are highly valuable. And the UK is the leading creator of formats internationally. And of course, what we've seen developing over the past 5 years or more is actually British independent producers being commissioned by international buyers to make new programming. So if you think of things like Gold Rush and other ones on Discovery, that's become a very important part of our international business. I'm just back from a major event in California called Real Screen. We had over 40 British independent producers there. It was the first post-COVID event. And actually, without the Brits being there, and the Scots and the Welsh and the Irish, Northern Irish, sorry, actually that event would not function. The American, North American buyers looked towards the UK as an R&D lab for global creativity. And of course, the fuel for that is our original commissions in the UK, because that's where we develop the credibility, it's where we can develop our business, where we can reinvest, and Channel 4 is an important part of that. So the knock-on effects of the Westminster government's plans are multiple. They're not just a direct loss of revenue, they actually impact on long-term growth, they reduce our competitiveness internationally. And I think this is something the government has not been willing to listen to. We, as I say, we have produced our own analysis on this in order to try and explain why this is such a bad idea. And I fear that with the government's plans, that the independent sector, which has been a shining light in the British creative industries, we will move to become more like a service sector rather than being creative entrepreneurs owning and controlling IP. We'll just be guns for hire. We'll be line producers who are hired by the new owners or global streamers to basically sell our creativity and work for a fee. And I don't think that's the right place to be in a 21st century economy. And I think it diminishes ambition and creativity overall.
Mm. Just to confirm, I mean, as you said earlier, there's no impact assessment coming from the UK government on any of this. No impact assessment on pros and cons of international work.
None at all. The assumption is somehow Channel 4 needs to compete with Netflix. That's a completely the wrong premise. Channel 4 needs to do something different from Netflix. We don't want to just watch lots of Netflix. We want to watch shows that Nicole makes about the Scottish Prison Service. We want to watch things on UK television which reflects and investigates and interrogates who we are as a society and all our views on that. And I think the idea that some of Channel 4 should become a homogenous competitor to Netflix is one, economically undoable, but also I think culturally diminishing. We want to see different perspectives in order to. I have no problem with Netflix. I have no problem with all the other streamers. They bring some amazing product, but they're doing a different job to the job that we want Channel 4 to do.
Thank you. Back to you, convener.
Thank you. Can I bring in Ms. Mintle, please?
Thank you, convener, and thank you, panel. As Mark said, that you've given quite stark evidence. I'd like to first turn to David Smith. You were quoted earlier this year by saying that Channel 4 and BBC are keystones. I think you used the word cornerstones today in Scotland's growing film and television production sector. Without these public service broadcasters, we would have no independent production sector, and highly rewarding jobs they create would be lost to us. You've touched on that, as has John McVeigh in his figures. Can you elaborate on that and explain your thoughts on what that this change could mean for the independent production sector in Scotland?
Yes, very much building on the comments already made by John and Nicole. Our report out today, one of the figures in it is that 196.6 million was spent by the BBC and Channel 4 on content production in Scotland in 2019. That's over half of all content spend in Scotland in that year. Now, the reason we're looking at 2019 is these studies take a long time to tender, to sign, complete, and COVID had an impact on our progress. We're currently working on 2021. And that should be published early next year. But that figure of 196 million has an additional impact, which is the 61.1 million the BBC and Channel 4 spend on their operations in Scotland. The majority of that has to be said from the BBC. They have a big presence at Pacific Quay in Scotland. They run a lot of departments out of Pacific Quay. The Channel 4 also has a presence in Glasgow with its creative hub, and Joe Street, I think, is on your next session. The loss of that commissioning value, that transfer of value that John described, to a single buyer who will then self-commission 75% of the content, as it will have a huge damaging impact on the sector as a whole, on independent production across the UK, on independent production in Scotland, and on our Scottish creative economy. Now, we ambitiously, Screen Scotland, have set out a proposal to build to double GVA by 2030. That's dependent on skills and infrastructure investment. It's also dependent to a large degree on continued commissioning from the PSBs. You know, without them, we will struggle to reach that figure. As Nicole said, it's about investment in businesses as well as investment in programmes, and it's about investment in skills and training development. We work very closely with Channel 4 on a project called multiple projects through a body called TRC Media in Glasgow. We developed the RAD Diversity Programme, Format Lab, Supersizer, Factual Fast Track, the International Programme. These are all programmes, personal development programmes, that are really business development programmes, because in the film and television sector, really, there isn't much. Production companies don't hold much infrastructure. They don't have much capital items on their balance sheet. It's mostly people. But you have to develop through the people to develop the businesses. Channel 4 has recognised that for years and worked very closely with Screen Scotland and its predecessors to develop the sector here. TRC Media is one example, Vectu Vision another example where we collaborate. But Channel 4 also has its own diversity scheme, which directly implants new trainees into production companies across Scotland, across multiple genres, and helps them build not just their confidence in their career, but also their connections with Channel 4 as a broadcaster. It's a people business. You have to have those relationships. You have to have the confidence to express your ideas. And Channel 4 plays a part in all of that.
Thank you, David. And John, I'm interested to get your thoughts as well. You mentioned the loss of $4.2 billion to the UK creative sector with regards to television and film production. Interested to know, we talk about a lot about the ideas, the producers, the directors, the researchers. What does this mean for the technical side as well, for these different roles within television and film production?
Yeah. Well, I mean basically, we are currently for freelancers for the labour market. Basically, as freelancers, you get hired when an independent producer gets commissioned, or BBC Studios gets commissioned in Scotland to make a show. So it follows that if there's less commissioning of Scottish independent producers, there'll be less work for Scottish freelancers. So it impacts. I mean, film and TV production is very interesting. It's one of the few activities which actually uses more of the rest of the creative industries than any other business, because we need designers, we need sound recordists, we need fashion and makeup and wardrobe, and all sorts of other creative industries are actually involved in creating a finished film or TV product. So it has multiple ripple effects across the broader creative industries. And, you know, it's not just about the money, it's about the skills, the long-term investment. I'm sure Nicole has fantastic relationships with leading freelancers in Scotland. So she will nurture and develop them. She'll rehire them for different shows. They will then develop their careers. They will then bring on assistants. So these are the downstream consequences of any diminished spend. Now, it's very hard for us. We've mapped and done an impact assessment on the direct consequences, but the downstream consequences are profound. That's a company that won't be set up. That's a set of relationships that won't happen because they won't be getting hired by Channel 4 to make that show for them. So, and I think that's the, you know, that's why it's sort of counterintuitive from the Westminster government to think that this will make a contribution to levelling up or economic growth across the UK. In fact, our view is, now, of course, whoever buys it will hire those freelancers, but they'll be making the shows themselves. It'll be a different set of relationships to the ones that you would get from multiple companies doing that as they were commissioned to make shows for Channel 4. And I think that's something else that the government, it seems, unwilling to talk about or consider.
Thank you, John.
Back in on that point. Thanks.
Thank you. Mr. Smith?
Sorry, I didn't see the microphone had been switched back on. I think John makes a good point there in terms of the industrial process of screen production. So most day in day out television production doesn't rely on large sets, large crews of people, but the high end work really does. Channel 4 worked with STV Studios to really break ground in Kelvin Hall in a separate vault where they built the prison set for Screw, a successful drama from Scotland, from a Scotland-based production company, entirely filmed and made within Kelvin Hall. It's a phenomenal series, but it's a series built on plasterers, joiners, electricians, scaffolders, drivers, security people. It's not just about those roles that you would imagine connect to television, you know, directors, producers, writers, editors, the usual jobs. There's a massive overspill chain. John's right, those people will still be employed by whoever buys Channel 4 when they produce those programmes in-house. My worry is that they won't be in Scotland. If you look at the way that ITV commissions its content, it doesn't commission a great deal of content from Scotland. The most recently published figures are from Ofcom for 2020, called the Made Out of London's report from Ofcom. In that period, ITV commissioned two projects from Scotland across the whole year, two programmes, Catchphrase and The Masked Singer, both of which were filmed outside of Scotland. We're from Scotland-based companies, but filmed in studios elsewhere, partly because we lacked studio capacity at that point in time. We've addressed that point. In the same period, Channel 4, across the nations, commissioned over 50 programmes. So not just within England, but excluding England, between Wales, Northern Ireland and Scotland, Channel 4 in the same period commissioned 50 programmes. Those were multiple-part series, often. There were dramas, there were entertainment shows, there were factual series. So it's not just a question of that's why it's difficult to say whether, you know, it depends who buys Channel 4. You can guarantee there's uncertainty. You can guarantee, based upon what's in the white paper, that 75% of that content will not be made by the independent sector anymore. It will be made in-house. If it's ITV or a similar buyer, it's likely that that activity will not take place in Scotland to the same extent.
Okay, thank you, David. I'd like to just turn to Nicole now. A useful segue into the independent sector. And I suppose you talked very clearly about the support that Channel 4 has given you. I'm interested to hear about if you're willing to share the support that you've given the freelancers and the training that you're able to provide, and how that an independent production company's business plan works, because we've heard a lot about everything being connected and collaboration, and the fact that you'll be pitching ideas to different broadcasters.
It's a very interesting question. So the way an independent production's business plan works is very difficult, because it's very difficult for us to plan in advance. So we pitch ideas, we hope they get commissioned, but when we come to write our business plan every year for the following year, there's very little secured business that we already have going into the next year. We probably have less than a fifth of our income for the following year secured, in the autumn when we're writing the business plan to start the next year. So it's an unpredictable business. One of the things that's been really important to us is to try and act as a buffer as a company, and to minimise how we pass on that insecurity down the freelancer chain. Because if we want to broaden the base of people who work in this fantastic creative industry, we need to make sure that we can get people from all kinds of backgrounds and not just people who can tolerate unstable employment. So we've always tried to take on new entrants to the industry and more junior employees on much longer contracts than we actually have secure work for, to make sure that we can get the best people and not just the people who can afford to work like that. And Channel 4 has been instrumental in supporting us doing that, partly because they support training posts. So we've had 9 new entrant training posts, which are a year long in Firecrest Films, and Channel 4 pay 50% of the costs of those trainees. But also because Channel 4 has always taken a strategic approach to commissioning. While they commission the best ideas, they also understand from our point of view how difficult it is to grow a business and to support emerging talent. So for example, with some of the returning series, Super Shoppers, for instance, they would commission 2 series at once so that we would have that kind of security going forwards and we can make those kind of commitments to people. And again, no other broadcaster has ever done that with us. That's what makes me really anxious about how this will go forward. It's an insecure industry. It's a mainly freelance industry. How do we carry on supporting people? And how do we carry on being confident about our business in the future? As I said in my first answer, it's much better for us now. We're a really strong and robust company, thanks to Channel 4's support through the years. We've emerged from COVID. We've had record years the last few years. And this year we're forecasting do 50% increase on turnover on last year. So we can cope a lot better with the insecurity, and we can definitely buffer much better and not pass that on now in ways that are really adverse. But I know that's not the same for other companies.
Okay, thank you. Thanks.
Can I bring in Ms. Boyack?
Thank you very much. It comes out very clearly that actually, at the moment, Channel 4 is doing pretty well in terms of production across the UK. It makes a profit. I wanted to focus particularly on the film sector, because the films that are produced and commissioned by Channel 4 appear to be more diverse, but they also appear to be award-winning and across the UK. I just want a bit of a comment on that, because it feels like there's a huge potential loss here if you look at the impact on the companies that potentially would take over, because it appears that they would lose some of their own production internally. So it feels like a lose-lose for everybody in terms of geography, private businesses and quality. So I was wondering who would maybe want to kick off first. John McPhee, do you want to kick off first? Across the sector, you've got quite a lot of evidence.
Yes, I mean, there's a report which will be produced shortly by the British Film Institute, which is an investigation into the dire circumstances of the British independent feature film sector, not television, just independent feature film, which has been, over the past 10 years, been in steady decline. in a world where more people have more access to more entertainment than we've ever seen in human history, sadly, the British independent feature film sector is not actually competing in that market, and that's to do with some fundamental economic problems and market failures. In the UK, we effectively have sort of 3 interventions in the market which support independent feature film. That's Film 4, which is £25 million a year, which is invested into British independent feature film, the BBC films, which have their own budget, and of course the BFI through the National Lottery, and then through that, the money that's devolved to Creative Scotland and others to invest in independent feature film. In the government's white paper, there is no mention about the future owners having any commitment whatsoever to independent feature film. So if I was a commercial buyer of Channel 4, given that Film 4 is generally loss-making, it's there because it's of its remit, and I'm a commercial buyer and I'm looking to get a return on my investment by Channel 4, it's very unlikely that I would continue to invest in independent feature film. So that would be £25 million less each year That would be invested in the independent feature film sector, and that would be very detrimental to Scottish independent feature film producers and directors and actors and everyone else. So I think you're right to focus on this. It's one of the points that hasn't really been highlighted much in the debate around Channel 4, but it would be a catastrophe for independent feature film at a time when it's already struggling to raise the finance it needs in the market because of changes post-COVID, and will be yet another loss of cultural entrepreneurship that we would expect to see being supported. So I think it's a very depressing day for our... We've got 70 established feature film companies as members of PACT, many of whom have benefited from Film 4 investment.
Thanks. That comes across really clearly. It's not often we get witnesses saying to us that a proposal will actually be a catastrophe. So thank you for that clarity. I was wondering if, Nicole Cleeman, do you want to make a comment on that about the quality of films being made, you know, in terms of BAFTA winning? These are not just being churned out. These are award-winning, culturally impactful films that have people being employed, whether it's actors, people behind the system that are actually making those films work. Do you want to give us a bit of a comment on the quality and what there is potentially to lose here?
I mean, it's difficult for me to talk about from the business because we don't make drama, we don't make film, but I would totally agree with you that these are high quality premium productions. They're award winning, they're world class. And you know, it's a grave concern. There's no reason for doing this. There isn't a problem here that needs a solution. And what I would certainly say around Channel 4 is that Channel 4 allows us to innovate, and innovation is the lifeblood of our creative industry. You know, whether we're in drama or in factual, you know, without that innovation, that's what's underpinning the UK creative economy. The streamers that the Westminster government wants Channel 4 to be more like don't innovate. You know, they don't do news, they don't do current affairs, they don't do investigations, they don't do observational documentary. They don't commission companies like us to take us inside institutions and showcase Scotland to the rest of the world. The kind of programmes the factual programmes that streamers make are retrospective stories with lots of twists and turns. They're not the kind of programmes that are key for a democratic society to make about itself and to examine itself.
Thanks very much. That's equally very useful in terms of that wider civic impact of Channel 4. David Smith from Screen Scotland, do you want to give us a particular comment in terms of filmmaking in Scotland? I think that issue of quality, but also the staffing issues and the just the behind-the-scenes impact of having private production companies in Scotland for filmmaking.
Sure. Reading from the notes here, Film 4 have won 37 Academy Awards and 84 BAFTAs across their existence. That speaks for itself. I mean, that's a phenomenal record. As John said, there are essentially, and I'm going to say four potential sources of funding within the Britain for film. There is the BFI, there is Film 4, there's BBC Film, and there's Screen Scotland. And our money, I'm not sure if I picked up John correctly, our money isn't devolved from the BFI, our money is direct from the National Lottery. We're a National Lottery distributor as well. We have a £4 million fund for feature film production from Scotland, and we regularly co-invest. But it's impossible to for any single body to finance a feature film. It just really doesn't happen. We work in collaboration with BBC Films, the BFI and Film 4 on almost every project. Obviously, not always the BFI, not always BBC Film and Film 4 at the same time. They operate separately, but it's ourselves, the BFI, and one or other of the broadcasters' film production arms at any given moment. And yet, they absolutely are the drivers of quality. They're the developers of talent. In Scotland, they work with the Young Film Foundation. Channel 4 and Film 4 are direct supporter of the Young Film Foundation, Christopher Young's Foundation in Sky, which is a kind of world leader in film talent development. So it's not just about the making of films, it's about the development of new talent. And because film is inherently an international pursuit, you know, you want your films to play as globally as possible. Again, that kite mark comes into play. You know, the fact that Film Forum have invested in a film alongside us means that when we take a film to Cannes or Venice or Berlin, that film is going to get bought, that film is going to get seen in cinemas globally, because Film 4 has that kite mark of quality that is very hard to replicate to anybody else other than, I would say, BBC Film in the UK.
Thanks very much.
Dr. Allen?
Thank you, Convener. A couple of you have, I think, said that this is a solution in search of a problem. And I just wonder, from a producer's point of view, for this is for John McVeigh and for Nicole Cleeman, what you see the motivation behind this exercise as being. We've heard that Channel 4 is not a financial basket case. It's difficult to see from what you've said today how these changes would help the independent sector in any way economically. So what do you think this is trying to achieve, this exercise?
Well, successive governments of various political views have regularly had a look at the public ownership of Channel 4. When they do, including Margaret Thatcher, who actually set up Channel 4 and then reviewed it shortly thereafter, thought that actual it remaining in public ownership was for the best purposes, for the best interests of the UK economy, both economically and culturally. So, sadly, the government has not produced any evidence to explain why it should be sold right now. It's quite right and proper that any government has a look at why do we collectively own a public service broadcaster. I think that's legitimate. But I think, given the all the other issues that we're facing as a society, with inflation, post-COVID recovery, and a number of other issues, not least the war in the Ukraine, that this seems to be a very strange time to want to sell off one of the national assets, which actually drives a lot of economic growth, it drives inclusion, and as other fellow panellists have explained, and is involved in many, many other issues around training and access. And of course, the government has not put in the white paper that the new owners would have any commitment to any of those issues either. So I don't know why the government wants to sell it right now. I've not seen any evidence. We have asked various members of the government to try and explain to us why now and why in such a draconian way, and we've not had an answer.
Thank you. And Nicole Cleeman?
I haven't got an answer for that either. I don't understand why they're doing it. I haven't seen any compelling explanation or rationale.
Okay, I wonder if I could ask in that case a related question, I suppose, which is Channel 4 provides a distinctive output in terms of news and current affairs. What do you think stands to be lost in that respect if this move goes ahead? What will be lost from the offering that exists within the UK around news and current affairs? I'd perhaps go to John again. In this case, go to John McVeigh and Nicole Cleeman.
Well, I mean, currently Channel 4, as Nicole will actually probably come on to, you know, Channel 4 does a whole range of factual, documentary, investigative programming, which could be broadly come under current affairs, including many of the excellent programmes that Nicole herself makes. In terms of news, we don't know what the future owners will do with news. We don't know if it'll be of the same scale, the same reach in terms of the reporters that they can embed in, around the world to report on stories that are critical to our knowledge and understanding of what's happening elsewhere in the world. But if you're a commercial owner, if we look at that, then you will always seek to do the minimum you're required to do under the licence you'll be granted from Ofcom. So until we see the terms of the sale, the nature of the licence that may be required on the new owners, it's hard to say what they will do, but the new owners will probably argue to invest less in news than Channel 4 currently would, because they'll be looking to make a return on their original investment and the money they've paid to the government to buy the channel in the first place.
Nicole Cleaver.
Well, Channel 4 Current Affairs built our business. We started off as a supplier making 10-minute films for Channel 4 News out of my spare room. That's how the company started. We grew by making dispatches films. All of our output was with Channel 4 until we started making films for Panorama, for BBC One. In 2020, Firecrest was the biggest supplier to Channel 4 Current Affairs. We made 11 hours of Current Affairs investigations in 2020. Current Affairs is not a commercial part of the television business. Those programmes can't really be sold overseas. Often our investigations are very UK-focused, they're very time-sensitive. It's not something anybody else I know has really built a business on. So I don't have a lot of confidence that a commercially run Channel 4, run for profit, would overinvest in the way that the current setup of Channel 4 has done in news and current. It remains to be seen what the Ofcom requirements will be on the new privatised Channel 4. But we know from looking at ITV Current Affairs that ITV Current Affairs is good. They've won BAFTAs. They make a certain kind of film. But what Channel 4 do, the BBC and ITV Current Affairs don't do it often is take on their own advertisers. You know, I've made films for Channel 4 about Cadbury, about TK Maxx, about Poundland, that involved right of reply and legal correspondence, and those people advertise on Channel 4. And I'm not that optimistic that a privatised Channel 4 would have the same bullish attitude.
Finally, a question, and that is for David Smith. You've been talking a bit, all of you, about how the purchase could involve 75% of the company falling into the hands, perhaps, of one giant. I just wonder if you could say a bit about what that would mean, David Smith, in terms of, if you like, the biodiversity of what would be on offer culturally. We've talked quite rightly about what the implications might be of this situation economically for Scotland, but just as Derry is keen to know how Derry is represented to itself through drama, so Scotland is too, and through other types of programming. What would be the impact culturally in terms of the diversity, do you think, of the offering, if so much of the channel was in the hands of one organisation?
I think it would be fairly disastrous again for audiences. You are essentially talking about an organisation self-commissioning its content. It's going to commission that content for reasons other than what's in the best interests of the UK or viewers. It's what's in the best interests of its PLC business bottom line. So diversity is not really served by what's proposed within the white paper. And it's not, we're not talking about this as 75. We've not made this up. And no, it's not what you're implying. But this is what the white paper says will happen. 25% will be ring-fenced for the independent production sector, as it is across all of the PSBs. And that's a massive change. Channel 4, I think it's come across quite clearly today, Channel 4 is fairly unique in its approach. It's a risk-taker. It tells you it's a risk-taker in almost every piece of its corporate communications. And it's true. It really does take risks. It really does, as Nicole just pointed out, it's not afraid to take on its own advertisers. It's not afraid to invest in films that represent parts of our culture that are maybe not mainstream. It's not afraid to reach out and work and do the right thing, really, is probably the best way of putting it. Channel 4 had no obligation 5 years ago to open an office in Glasgow. It did. It reached out and it expanded its base. Now, you could argue that there was some political pressure that motivated that change, but they realised it was the right thing to do quite early on and moved very quickly. The current administration within Channel 4 that is, the previous administration were slightly less quick off the mark. But Alex and her team at Channel 4 have been very responsive and very good at developing a varied culture across the UK. If one organisation self-commissions 75% of its content internally, it's hard not to describe that as a monoculture.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Simpson?
Yeah, I'm just watching the clock. I don't know if Mr. Cameron... Ms. Cameron doesn't have any questions. OK. So I'll just say from the outset that I probably learned more about Channel 4 than I ever knew this morning, because, frankly, I've just been a viewer of television rather than someone who pays any attention to who makes the programme. So it's been really, really interesting. So I've got a question for each of you. And we haven't got long, we've got about 5 minutes, so probably quick answers. So, Nicole, we'll go to you. So your question is, listening to you this morning and looking at what we've got in front of us, your business isn't entirely based on Channel 4. You've made some very successful programmes for other people, which seems to me eminently sensible. So if Channel 4 was to be privatised, how would it affect your business and indeed others? Is anyone completely reliant on Channel 4? And I've got supplementary to that, because you were mentioning the investigative programmes you made. Who comes up with the ideas? Is that you, or does somebody approach you?
So to answer your first question first, Firecrest Films, like a number of indies in Scotland, was very heavily reliant on Channel 4 in the early days. The companies like IWC, Fine Strike Productions, Raise the Roof, we were all nurtured by Channel 4 in our early days. And then we've now grown away from Channel 4. So 5 years ago, Channel 4 accounted for about 2/3 of our turnover. It's around 1/3 of our turnover now, as we've diversified. And again, those companies I mentioned have all followed the same pattern. So it's the newer companies that it's going to affect. Who's going to support those new companies? To answer your question about our current affairs investigations, we've got a wider team here that look at things. Sometimes journalists bring us stories. Sometimes whistleblowers call us and ask us to look at stuff. But I would definitely add to that that if I have a story that is in any way risky, I would always take it to Channel 4 first.
Okay, that's really interesting. I'm going to move to John McVeigh, and it follows up on the question that Alistair Allen asked. So I, as a TV viewer, if Channel 4 is privatised, how does it affect me, and what is on offer to me?
Well, what will be on offer will be whatever the new owners decide you will get, but they'll be using their own in-house production to do that. So I would, and it's very, you know, it's not to say that what will be on offer will be necessarily less quality. ITV makes very good quality shows, is a popular commercial broadcaster, but it'll be commercially focused. It'll be looking at an ROI on every single slot in the schedule in order to make money to pay the shareholders of who owns Channel 4. That is a very different motivation to the current commissioning that Channel 4 currently does, because it doesn't have to pay shareholders. All the money it makes goes back into programming, goes back into commissioning great investigative shows from the Coal and others in Scotland. So it's not to say that you as an audience will see less quality, but you'll see different programming. It won't be the same, because there's a very different model driving the commissioning of the channel going forward.
Okay, I could follow up on that, but there's no time. So quick one for David Smith. I'm going slightly off tangent here, David. I was down at Leith Docks yesterday, saw your massive building there, would have loved to have gone inside. But you'll be aware that there's a bid for Freeport status there, and I think you may be involved. If you're not involved, okay. Well, my question was going to be, if it was to achieve that status, how would it help you? Perhaps it wouldn't.
Well, we are not the operator of the studio. We are the kind of head leaseholder. First Stage Studios operate the studio within the Leith Dock facility. You're very welcome. If you get in touch, I'll speak to the team at First Stage, and I'm sure they'll be very happy to take you inside. It is astonishingly huge once you're inside. And it's just been vacated by its second Amazon production, massive production, Anansi Boys. And we are very confident. We can't say much more, but we know what's coming in next. So it's a very busy facility. I don't think the Freeport would necessarily impact upon our part of it. We have a lease over the space for a number of years. It's also worth mentioning that that's not the only studio in Scotland. Since that came online, we now have the Pyramids facility in Bathgate. We've got Ward Park in Cumbernauld. Kelvin Hall's about to open in Glasgow. There's Pioneer Studios in Glasgow. So it is again quite a varied offering. We need more. We think we can grow further if there are more facilities.
Well, Cumbernauld's in my region, so maybe that's the one I should be visiting. I'll leave it there. Thank you.
I'm a bit comfortable at time if you do want to ask that final question that you had.
I'm quite comfortable. Thank you.
Okay. Can I thank you all for your attendance at committee this morning? It's been a really interesting topic. And also thanks for your briefings prior to today's meeting. I'm now going to suspend very briefly to allow the witnesses to change over online. A very warm welcome back, and our second panel this morning is on Channel 4, and indeed it's members of Channel 4 who are here with us. We've got Alex Mayon, Chief Executive, Joe Street, Head of Daytime and Features and Head of Glasgow Hub, and Bryony Robinson, Senior External Affairs Manager. I hope you were able to hear the first panel. I think something that came through quite strongly for me was the importance of relationships and location in Scotland. And I just wondered if you could maybe elaborate on Format Lab and the new partnership with BBC Screen Scotland and Glasgow Council, and how that might impact on the output from the Kelvin Hall studios in particular. So if I could go to maybe Mr. Mahon first.
Good morning. Thank you very much for having us. I'm going to hand to my team, Bryony and Joe, to talk about that particular relationship impact, if I can. But I would just start off reiterating your point that it is very much a relationship-driven industry. And perhaps that's particularly because of what you've heard from your first witnesses about the scale of companies, particularly that we work with and the areas that we work in, which are about innovation, taking risk, new talent, and early stage staff or young people coming into the industry or companies, where we're really focused on our quite unique and vital role in how we grow those companies and how we give people a chance to develop, whether it's careers or the work they're involved in a way that being a not-for-profit allows us to and allows us to take that risk. So, Joe O'Brien, you know specifically about that partnership. Does one of you want to speak to the precise impact?
I can do that.
Thanks, Joe.
Mm-hmm. Hello, morning, everyone. Thank you for having us. So, for those that don't know, my department, Daytime and Features, which is based in the Glasgow Hub, is responsible for commissioning returnable shows, high volume, and quite often formatted shows. So when Format Lab was mooted and during the kind of consultation about did we need another resource, do we need another studio, the resounding answer came, yes, we did. And what we needed to do as well was to upskill the community. We've got an amazing production community in Scotland, but we all know that the IP is the valuable resource, and formats were a very good and efficient way for companies to get good saleable international IP. So Format Lab has been a collaboration between all the agencies you talked about in terms of us identifying talent, putting resources in place to get placements with companies, upskill already talented, maybe researchers, APs, but to get them thinking about shows that can be based in studio, absolutely with a lens on innovation, but also broad popular shows that can become returning fixtures in our schedules, for example. So to have Kelvin Hall, we've already had several shows where we just haven't had studio capacity in Scotland to make the shows we wanted to in Scotland. They've had to go down the road to Salford or be made elsewhere. And so Format Lab is about bringing together all the skills we already have, leveraging team that I have in the Glasgow Hub with skills in that sector. It's an industry of relationships, as you said at the beginning. The fact that we're here, the fact that we know each other, we know who the good people are who have the aptitudes, has been transformational, really, across the board in a lot of the skills work that we're doing in Channel 4 broadly, but specifically out of Glasgow as well.
Okay. Bryony, do you want to add anything to that?
I think just that Format Lab is all about trying to maximise the impact of Kelvin Hall, and so trying to develop that entertainment space. And I think one thing we're looking to do is to diversify the Scottish sector and make sure it's kind of delivering commissions across the widest range of genres, including some of those really high value formats. And so Format Lab is a great example of partnership as well with Screen Scotland, with the BBC, and a number of our Scottish training schemes are developed in partnership like that. And I think it shows how we can have impact when we work together.
Thank you. Can I bring Mr. Ruskell in first?
Yeah, thanks, Convener, and thanks for joining us this morning. We heard from the first panel about the status of Channel 4 oversees what high regard the channel's seen in and its productions, and how the independent sectors are a really key driver of that success. So I wanted to ask you the same question I asked the first panel about how privatisation may affect that international work and that international standing of the channel and what it produces.
Good morning. I think two things, and I should state, first of all, that I ran a large independent production company that was global for many years before being at Channel 4. In fact, most of my career has been international, so I can probably speak to that with some experience. There would be kind of two effects. One is about IP, and the other is about the image of Britain and Scotland abroad. The IP is a sort of fundamental part of how Channel 4 is currently constructed, which is that we are currently constructed as called a publisher broadcaster, which really means that we can't own the IP. The intellectual property and things that we buy fits within all the companies that we work with. It sits within those partner companies on their balance sheets, if you like, not on ours. And that has been really the fundamental driver of exports for the creative economy across the UK. So the companies that you heard from, like Firecrest, they own those programmes, which means they can sell them abroad. They can work with organisations like PACT or Screen Scotland. They can create their own export pipeline. So that's really what has led to a huge amount of growth in the consolidation of big production companies like Shine or All Through Media or Endemol, is that ability to make your show in Scotland and then to sell it to 200 other territories or to remake it in those countries. So it brings money and the potential to export. That's been a huge factor in the growth of the industry. The proposal with privatization would mean that that no longer exists. The intellectual property would be owned within Channel 4. That's a fundamentally different model. And the second piece is, I guess, a sort of soft power point, which is portrayal and how we're represented abroad. So you heard at the end of that session a particular focus on film. And as you heard, we spend 25 million a year on film through Film 4. BBC Film spends, I think, about 8 million a year. We're by far the biggest funder. We focus on innovation and risk and new directors and new writers rather than making money. If you think of a film like Limbo or Wild Rose, or of course Trainspotting and Trainspotting 2, something like Limbo, which was shot in newest Scottish writer, Scottish director, has exported really well. I don't think those kind of shows would exist because they're not commercially profitable. So that sort of portrayal of parts of Scotland that the rest of the world sees perhaps would not be there. I'm not sure how many other films have been shot in North or South Uist, but it's that kind of work that we do that is quite fundamental to our purpose in terms of representation of different parts of the UK that would be different.
Yeah. Thanks so much.
Thank you. Can I invite Mr. Cameron, please?
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. My questions are really around Channel 4 in Scotland, and you've obviously launched in 2018 the For All the UK strategy, which has resulted in significant investment. But I just wondered if you could help with a comparison to Channel 4 in, say, Wales, Channel 4 in Northern Ireland. Give us some kind of sense of the contrast between what your operations here in Scotland and elsewhere in the UK. I appreciate it's quite a general question, but an overview, if possible. Can I start with Alex Mahon, please?
Morning. Well, I don't want to get in trouble anywhere else, but we haven't got offices in the other locations that you mentioned. So the first difference would be that we chose quite carefully to put the hub office in Glasgow. And we chose to do that. We looked at a lot of locations. We chose two locations for hubs. The other one is in Bristol. We thought extremely carefully about going places where we could make a significant impact on the industry as it was at that stage in the location. So it was quite an involved pitch process with many, us traveling to many different locations and then pitching to us. And we thought that we would make a significant impact in Glasgow, and that by choosing to locate there with the multiplicity of things we do, we'll talk about digital and about skills, as well as about commissioning and programming, that we could have a sort of bigger than 1+1=2 impact. So our Glasgow hub is about creating that activity, particularly about spending money in Scotland. So we have located Joe Street, who's on with me today. She runs the biggest commissioning department across the whole of Channel 4, both in terms of spend and in terms of hours. I think responsible for a bit more than 50% of the hours that were on the channel last year. So she's doing that for the whole organisation from Scotland. So that has impact on how decisions are made, has impact on how creative decisions are made for the whole organisation, because it comes with the perspective of someone who doesn't live in London. So there's that impact. There's then the impact of spend in Scotland, where we spend about 22 million in particular in Scotland, supporting about 400 jobs and about, you know, thousands of jobs across the industry. That makes a difference. So I think those are the big impacts that we've created by being particularly focused in Glasgow. When it comes to Northern Ireland or Wales, we're obviously spending money in those locations through our commissioning operations elsewhere, but I don't think it's the same volume of impact that we can make through the Glasgow office. I don't know, Bryony, if you want to pick up on the question about the other locations. Does that help answer it?
Yes, it does. I mean, I should add that I suppose another comparison is with what you're doing within England itself, and you mentioned the Bristol hub. I'm just trying to get a sense of where Scotland fits within the kind of UK strategy. But yes, please, could I turn to Joe Street, please? Sorry, or is that Bryony? Bryony or Joe? Joe, why don't you start, please?
Okay. I'll start, seeing as I'm here. Okay. I suppose one of the really big impacts is a kind of very subtle and cultural change that having a head of a network department in Scotland brings to the broader production sector. Brian will correct me if I'm wrong. I think I am the only network head in Scotland across PSBs or commercial broadcasters, and that matters, and it matters to producers, because historically there's been a culture that, a belief, true or not, that business is done in the corridors of Horsefree Road, or you bump into somebody in central London. So shifting that soft cultural way of working and having decision makers who are holding big budgets in Scotland really matters, and matters to the production sector. What we're also able to do by being here, we can be a hub base to colleagues in Northern Ireland, to production sectors. So there's always been quite a good synergy with colleagues there. And I think that shifting the centre of gravity about how we think about things, how we live our lives, is, it matters, and it permeates through my team, which is based mainly in Scotland, but I have team members in Bristol, I have team members in Leeds and London, is the power sits in Scotland for a change, and that matters. And it gives us a lens with which to look at how we commission in Wales as well. And it's the start of a sea change, I would hope.
And Bryony, please.
So I think for the UK is about benefiting all of the UK, you know, in every corner of the UK, and our spend allows us to do that. But I think having people on the ground makes a huge difference in terms of those relationships and facilitates that spend. I think one thing we do that we've not touched upon is the way we support independent production companies. So we've got production companies who are on our emerging indie fund based in Scotland. So Channel X, Hopscotch and Black Camel Pictures. So that's supporting really high potential, relatively new emerging companies to kind of supercharge their growth. We've also got our growth fund, which actually takes stakes in businesses. And that's kind of supporting three Scottish companies. We've announced another company this Week, which is a scripted company, which is really positive and kind of supports that diversification I mentioned. So I think we, by supporting businesses to grow and investing in training and skills, we're really enabling that growth in the sector, which is really positive. And you've seen from the new Screen Scotland numbers out today that actually the projection is the sector will reach 1 billion by 2030. And so I think the success in Scotland is something we're looking to emulate elsewhere. I think we're seeing good growth and kind of starting to see more diversification in Wales. We've just announced a Welsh language opera last week in Wales. But I think Scotland actually is kind of ahead of the curve in terms of that growth and that diversification and that kind of work. And I think that's really positive and what we want to see in the other nations of the UK.
Thank you. Thank you very much for that. My final question is about consumption of Channel 4 in Scotland. In 2021, Ofcom compiled a report which found that the Channel 4's main channel percentage share of the total TV audience was 4.7%, which was a little lower than the rest of the UK, which was at 5%. Now, it's a pretty small margin, but I just wondered if there was any... What reason you could place on that? Is there any reason for just a marginally lower consumption rate? And Brian, why don't you start? Yeah.
So I think the landscape is slightly different in Scotland. So obviously STV has a slightly higher share than its kind of equivalents in some of the other nations. So that perhaps is behind that slight difference. But I'd also say, you know, that linear share is just one viewing metric. In that same report points to 40% of households in Scotland using all four. And Channel 4 is the youngest skewing PSB. So we are pivoting to digital more rapidly than our competitors. So I think if you actually looked at younger Scottish audiences, that figure's likely to be higher. We know that about 80% of 16 to 34s are registered on all four. So I think it's kind of important to look at those wider metrics, particularly digital viewing, when you're thinking about Channel 4's impact.
Thank you. I don't know if any of our other witnesses want to comment on that, but that's fine for me.
Thank you. Could I bring in Ms. Mintle, please?
And thank you, panel, for joining us this morning. I started my first question with a quote that David Smith, Director of Screen at Screen Scotland, said, Channel 4 and the BBC are keystones in Scotland's growing film and television production sector. Now, Joe, I think I remember you from BBC Scotland. So I'd be interested to get your thoughts on that specifically, perhaps both from a BBC Scotland perspective and a Channel 4 perspective, and how both broadcasters support public service broadcasting in Scotland.
Yeah, hello again.
Hi.
The relationship with Screen Scotland, I think, has been revelatory for me, actually, since I moved across to Channel 4. It sort of coincided with David's tenancy as well as director of Screen there. And it's incredibly collaborative, I think, is the first thing to say. We're able to work closely and strategically, and there's a shorthand to saying, where's the skills gaps? What are we missing? How are we going to support together to leverage the power of Channel 4 and how we're investing in the production sector, production companies, but also individuals, young people coming into the industry? We're both funders of TRC. I myself sit on the board of TRC. So we can be incredibly aligned in projects, initiatives that both parties will promote and support. I think in a kind of practical and operational way, the first thing I did when I joined Channel 4 is we did a Screen Scotland initiative in daytime, which resulted in a 15-part commission for a small Scottish indie, which will hit air later this year, Beezer's Tool Club. And so this year, what we've been able to do is encourage colleagues. So Entertainment are doing a similar initiative. I think David spoke to that earlier in the sessions, but that will be a show at Christmas with a view to that being a returnable entertainment format.
there's that closeness of working together, identifying opportunities, gaps, and it being a genuine and collaborative, meaningful relationship is really important. So it means as well that we can spread the benefits. I think what I observed when I was in the BBC is it's a bigger machine to navigate. It was going through a central thing that I wasn't part of. I have much more control and much more autonomy, which, again, it's sort of part of that Channel 4 risk-taking mentality that Alex and my boss Ian invested in me taking this job, is can sort of roll your sleeves up and get things done. Mm-hmm. And that's important. It speaks again as well to the kind of legacy of relationships, of being in Scotland and of having that presence and understanding the sector and the people that we're talking about.
That's really helpful, yeah. Jo. Thank you very much.
I just add, though, to that?
Of course.
Thank you. I think there's sort of two things that come together in what Jo's saying and also in Mr. Cameron's kind of last question, which is the role that Channel 4 plays in what we're trying to do now, which is to represent the whole UK. The question about why an audience is watching as much, you know, our hope would be that as you adjust shows over time and as you make them more representative, you get that uplift. So last year, after I got a hard time from another Scottish committee, we put a Scottish family into Gogglebox. Lo and behold, the programme's gone up 3% in Scotland, right? That's not rocket science, but that's exactly what we should be doing. And then the other piece that you've heard from your previous witnesses is that we are there at the skills and the training and the small and the risky point. And that's our role. We find that fundamentally an important part of our role. You will see that in the white paper for privatisation, the provision to do skills and training has been deleted as part of our organisational remit. And you've heard that we would not be required to be present outside of London. However, it's that combination of things which is really, really important when industries are a fledgling or a building up or a scaling point. And as you know from the report that came out about the future of the industry in Scotland, that work takes decades, not a sort of 1 year and you're out, right? It takes time. When it's done well, it comes together in a network of things that work together to build an industry and give a sustainable route for young people into it in ways that they wouldn't otherwise get. But it does take quite a lot of quite precise, fine and expensive work to build up companies to a scale where they can survive by themselves.
Thank you for that, Alex. I would say that I think your graphic at the end of programmes, which shows where your programmes are made, is really obvious. And I did notice that the Gogglebox one now covers the whole of the landmass. So thank you for doing that. Kind of following on from what you've just said, we got some really powerful evidence from Nicole Cleeman of Firecrest Films talking about the benefit of collaboratively working with Channel 4 and the support that you are able to give in training, longer commissions, etc., etc. So it would be useful to hear, perhaps, Bryony, from your perspective as the External Affairs Manager, how you see that working and the benefit that Channel 4, being that nimble, innovative organisation, has been able to do.
Yep. So we work with independent production companies in lots of different ways. I mean, Jo is the expert because Jo is doing this day in, day out. But Firecrest are one of our growth fund companies, but I think we've kind of worked with Firecrest right from their inception. So Channel 4 is often a route for a first commission for a lot of new companies. I think that's a really important role in the industry. So a lot of Firecrest's initial commissions were with us, and then we supported them with what was Alpha Fund, which is now our emerging indie fund. So some support to help them do more development to grow. And then I think they've had 9 production trainees. So our production training scheme is all about improving representation in the industry, but it's about working with our supply chain, because Channel 4 only has about 1,000 employees ourselves, but our supply chain has more than 10,000 jobs. So actually, supporting skills in our supply chain is really important and valuable. So we pay 50% of the salary, and we provide wraparound training and do the recruitment, kind of things that can be a bit of a blocker for indies. And we've had some brilliant production trainees, you know, that's helping to bring great people into the industry, but also people from different backgrounds. So that's been a benefit for Firecrest and for other companies in Scotland. We're currently recruiting for 3 more positions. Actually, if you look at the last 2 cohorts, about 20% of the placements on that scheme have been in Scotland, which I think is really positive. And then Firecrest also joined our growth fund, where we've taken a stake in the business, which is about getting to that next level and providing wraparound support for the business to grow. So we're trying to support businesses through all different stages. With Two Rivers, who are another growth fund company, we're supporting them to move more into the digital space, because that's not a space they've done a lot of work in. So I think the way we work with different indies is really bespoke, and kind of depending on their needs and how we can work with them to add value. I think Joe can probably add more. Okay.
Do we have time to go to Joe?
I'm happy to. I've already mentioned the kind of work we do very closely with TRC. We've currently got a funded placement as part of the Factual Fast Track, actually working in the Glasgow office here as a commissioning executive. I signed up the other day, actually, 2 junior members of the office here to work with GMAT to do some outreach work in schools locally, because, again, as part of a drive for underrepresented groups in particular, and that presence of Channel 4 in Glasgow, of having people here doing jobs at every level, is really potent for that pipeline of the next generation of talent and those opportunities. Bryony's mentioned the work that the production trainee scheme places people in indies. We've got big returning drama, Screw, which will be filming in Kelvin Hall later in the year. That's got training schemes in there for ex-offenders. You know, it's a prison drama. It's a really kind of innovative way of Channel 4 making a difference in Scotland. We've got an apprentice in our office who never in a million years thought she would have an opportunity to work in this industry. She had her kind of 6-month review yesterday and is absolutely cherishing every opportunity that she's getting. The people in this office, we work with Strathclyde Uni, Stirling, City of Glasgow, University of West of Scotland. All of my team, wherever they are in the UK, there happen to be more of them in Scotland, are all, we have mentees. We work with organisations to keep that pipeline going. So it's that thing in parallel again between all the very official corporate emerging indies, all of that investment and that on the boots on the ground work, because we're here and visible with that open door policy. That one of the joys, I think, of Channel 4 being here, I genuinely think now it's possible to have a career in Scotland through the door as a runner to running a department and never have to move anywhere else. And I think it's only because Channel 4 is here that that's absolutely possible, because they've made the investment into Scotland.
Okay, thank you, convener.
Ms Boyack.
Thank you very much. It's been good to hear your evidence today. I was really struck when I read the justification for privatisation, that from Nadine Doris herself, it would give Channel 4 the tools and freedom to flourish and thrive as a public service broadcaster long into the future. Yet the evidence we've had today is that although you're not for profit, you do make money, and you made 74 million last year, which was reinvested into the sector. We've had a lot of evidence about really positive impact in Scotland, production, quality of filmmaking, training and skills, diversity. So I was wondering, to kick off, Alex Mahon, could you put on record for us today what Channel 4 has presented as your alternative to privatisation? I understand you've made that feedback to DCMS. I think it'd be just good to get it on the record to say how you would want to go forward to deliver the success you've had in the past.
Thank you very much. Last year's figures, which we've released, actually, I'll just take a moment to say, were even better than the ones you quoted. We made 1.2 billion in revenues, which is an absolute all-time high and record.
we made 100 million, 101 million, what we call surplus, which just gets reinvested. We have about 272 million in cash sitting on the balance sheet. We have no debt, and really, like, unbelievably record-breaking in terms of our financial success. So I would say we're in an extremely strong financial position, the strongest we've ever been in our 39 and a half year history. Hopefully we'll make it to 40. And as you've heard from some others, we've had huge success with young people, particularly as we've switched to streaming. Now, I would just say involving 16 to 34-year-olds and making sure that they see proper, regulated, impartial news and fact-based programming, we all know that that's more important than ever before in today's society. So we did lay out an alternative plan to privatisation. You will know that 96% of the consultation responses were negative on privatisation. But we thought quite carefully about what we should lay out as an alternative, because I do believe that we should never be standing still. For the record, I do not believe in just preserving the status quo. And I come from a background of running privatized organizations for profit. So, you know, I thought quite carefully about if one wasn't to do that, why? And I really focused on how we would increase our wider civic impact and how we would, if you like, create a bigger public dividend as a reason to remain public. And we laid out a sort of set of key things. One was a bigger commitment to the nations and regions, so becoming even more representative of the UK, so putting formally in place a regulated target to spend 50% of money outside of London, shifting to a few more hundred roles outside of London so that we would be a truly national broadcaster. Perhaps more excitingly, a real double down of focus on skills and training individuals. So we are at the moment a year into training 10,000 young people a year to come into the industry, but we propose to double that investment to create opportunities over the next decade for 250,000 young people. And that creates sort of 2 billion worth of value because of the investment in those people and their careers. And we also committed to setting up a four skills school, like a physical skill school. The only one that exists in the UK for this industry is the NFTS, which is in Beaconsfield outside of London. But we wanted to set up another school somewhere outside of the southeast, in the north, presumably, which would really, really be a sort of career centre for people. I'd want to say that if you're young, and you will know this from your work as a committee, if Scotland is to grow like that, it needs the young people that are trained to have the skills in the sector. If you are 14, which is when a lot of people make their exam decisions about what they're going to do, so effectively pick their careers, if you don't know anyone in the media and you've never met anyone in the media, it would never occur to you that you could do that. I mean, I grew up in Scotland. It never occurred to me. I didn't know anyone in the media. It, as an industry, it is only the only industries that are more socially exclusive are law and medicine. It's really shocking that media would come third. So the work we do of working in schools, starting to work in schools in Scotland next year, that work really changes the perspective and the prospective hopes for young people, because once they meet Channel 4 people and they'll come into our schemes, they feel it's a brand they can access. They feel an affinity to the brand in the way that maybe they don't to posher broadcasters. So we can really make a difference there. And so we really thought about that skills point. And clearly part of our plan was to remain not-for-profit, to remain, if you like, recycling the money into other companies and remain as a publisher broadcaster. As you will know, that is not the plan that the government wished to pursue. We laid out the economic case of the next episode. It would generate 11 billion of GVA, including 3.5 billion specifically in the nations and regions. It would create another 13,000 jobs, 40% of them in the nations and regions. So it was a very much a plan focused on skills, training young people. It was focused on how we could spread the creative economy around the UK. And it, of course, it was focused on continuing to remain British as a company and invest in Britishness in terms of the IP that we put on air. Sorry, that helped lay it out. Is that too much detail?
No, that's actually a very helpful summary. I mean, actually, on one level, it's actually building on success. I think that's the thing I personally find quite hard, is that Channel 4 is successful, and particularly the For All the UK, and the it's almost like levelling up in practice with the evidence that you spread investment across the UK, it does work. Can I just get you to mention briefly the issue about the quality of film production and the importance of that on the ground in terms of both the people in the film sector, in terms of artists, the people behind the cameras, and the impact of that diversity of programming we got from other witnesses, the number of BAFTA wins. Do you want to say a little bit about the success of the film side, which is really critical given the difficulty in doing film production because it is very expensive? So to be able to do that in a not-for-profit context that makes profit, could you say a little bit about that?
Yes, certainly. And of course, there's fundamentals that are the same between film and television, which are risk-taking. Let's unpack what risk-taking is. It's normally innovation and creativity. So it's new stories, new writers, new directors, new ways of putting things. And that we get to do that for not-for-profit, but we also get to do it because it's part of what's written down as our purpose, is to be challenging and to come up with new opinions. Of course, that's often what gets us into this kind of trouble. But that's the sort of purpose of the organisation. And so therefore, we seek out to work with diverse and new filmmakers. And that is fundamentally what my team in Film 4 do. There's a team of development professionals who spend all of their time looking for the new, the untested, the people who haven't been given a chance, the stories that haven't been represented. When you are running an organization for profit, that tends to be the exact opposite of what you do because you have to make a profit. So what you're searching for is the things that you can prove will make money. And the untested and the untrialed and the brand new and the fledgling are often not that. So, you know, directors like Steve McQueen or Danny Boyle are now hugely successful, but they started off with us when they were unproven and untested. And that's a fundamental part of our model. So we are in all kinds of little films, new filmmakers, funding their short films, working with them to help through their careers. And that kind of work is quite nurturing. Like it's about encouragement and it's about working hand in glove. It's not about closing down things that won't work. It's a very, very different way to approach the film industry. It can result after three or four projects in tremendous success, but you must have the three or four projects that might not go anywhere first and are wonderful pieces of work. So I think we approach the film industry that way. And you can sort of hear from hundreds of filmmakers who've worked with us in that way. And we also take risks on projects. So, you know, on the television side, for example, we had on last year, Putin, a Russian spy story, 3 episodes. I know from the producers there that no other broadcaster would touch that and no streamer would touch that. It's classified as too dangerous, that kind of documentary, too dangerous, too worrisome. And that's the kind of risk that we run headlong into. So it's about what the stories are and why should that be exposed and why is that important as well. And my fear would be if that were to be eliminated, you wouldn't see the new work come and then we would run out of British or Scottish talent who've been developed. I know from conversations that Netflix and Amazon, expensive and wonderful as they are, regard us as a kind of $250 million a year research and development shop. Thanks very much. You develop those people, thank you. And there's nothing wrong with that, right? But you need the research and development shop, and that innovation costs money and is done at a loss.
But it's a critical part of the industry going forward. You're creating jobs, you're creating talent, and it's diversity that we're not getting from anywhere else. Really impactful. Thanks very much.
Thank you. I'm a wee bit conscious of time, so we could try and be succinct, Dr. Allen.
Yeah, just one question, really. Thank you, convener. And that's, I suppose, for Alec or anyone else who wants to join in. But we've talked about this benefit that there is economically for individuals, culturally, in what Channel 4 does in terms of bringing new people on. I think one thing we maybe haven't talked about so much is writing. We've talked about how it's important to portray Scotland, to portray places within Scotland. Part of that surely is about encouraging writing, old and new, within Scotland. And I just wonder, A, what's happening on that front, and B, what privatisation would mean for it.
Joe, do you think you're best placed to take that? Thank you very much.
Well, I can... I don't work in scripted, so it's a view rather than an expert position. But I think in terms of... We had Murder Island last year, which was an Ian Rankin project, so strong Scottish writing. Screw, I think, is a phenomenal success for the Scottish writing community because it's a returning drama. My neighbour I know is writing for it, having moved from BBC projects, and I think it's about opportunity and risk taking again on pipeline of talent. I think, Bryony, have you? I. It's not a genre I have a lot of knowledge in, out with, you know, the two projects that I've mentioned.
Yeah, happy to come in. So we're supporting Scottish writers in a range of ways. So for the first time in the last year, we've had our production training scheme have a specific scripted cohort, and four of those placements are in Scotland, three with Black Camel and one with Two Rivers, and they're partway through those placements now. So that's all about new Scottish scripted talent. We also support the Young Film Foundation's work. So there's a year-long programme working with seven really high potential new Scottish writers. That's a kind of partnership. It's got a number of partners involved, but that's in it. It's got a residency on Sky for a week. And this year, for the first time, there's support from the broadcasters for them to write a script, each to write a script for one of the broadcasters for a feature film or scripted programme. So I think we're doing a lot around scripted and something like Film 4-2. So Limbo has been mentioned a few times today. Limbo is the first feature from Ben Sherrick. So he's the director and writer. So I think there's lots of different ways in which we're trying to bring through new, exciting Scottish voices. And also with digital, I think digital, we've not touched upon as much as we could. We've got a digital commissioner based in the Glasgow office, and she's trying to find exciting new voices, including in the comedy space. So there's lots of different avenues, but those authentic voices are really critical because we don't want to be just spending money in Scotland. It's about representing Scotland back to Scotland and to the whole of the UK and actually globally.
Thank you.
Convener?
5 minutes, yes.
5 minutes, okay. We'll be quick. Alex, you mentioned working with schools. Can you say bit more about that, where the schools are?
Well, as part of our four skills programme, we're kind of doing a set of training initiatives that bring 10,000 young people a year into the industry. So sometimes that's apprenticeships, sometimes that's specific courses, funding with partners for, say, working with ex-offenders or working with teenagers without qualifications. But sometimes actually that work is earlier in the key stages in schools of going into schools and doing a program there so that younger kids, I think it's key stage sort of six, so maybe like 12, 13, 14, understand what a career in the media might be. And they get a sense, as you've just heard, that you could write and be in television and film, or that you could be a digital native, like, which is people younger than us, and be trained enough to know that there's a career for you in the media, but you need to learn how to polish those skills and to hone them and not just be on Snapchat all the time, but that you can use that knowledge to build a career. And it's exposing kids to that at an early enough stage that they see that as a possibility. So we go into schools and do a specific program with them to do that. And sometimes it's our own staff going in to speak. Sometimes it's designing that. Sometimes it's giving them a film into our day in the life work so that they think it's a possibility. And we work with specialist partners to do all of that. We've been doing that in schools elsewhere, and we start in schools in Scotland in 2023. So it's changing the perspective and the potential for young people as they think about careers and what they might do.
Okay, that's great. Now, you mentioned earlier some figures, and you've obviously been doing really well. So trying to understand the motive of the government in this, the UK government, is there any advantage to the UK government of having Channel 4 financially or not?
Well, Channel 4 doesn't cost the Westminster government anything. It doesn't cost the public anything. It's financially independent. We are not, our balance sheet is not backed up by government, so we don't cost anything. We earn all our money from mostly advertising, and effectively we recycle that money into other companies. And actually, you know, that the concern about the consequences of doing that, of privatizing the organization, is what drives the interest and the noise that you hear from the industry. Because there's no financial benefit directly in terms of a dividend or other things to the Treasury. The financial benefit is in the gross value added in terms of the impact of all of those other companies on the sector. And, you know, depending on whose evidence you look at, removing Channel 4 into private hands would have an impact of somewhere between 2 and 4 billion negatively over the next decade, because the profits would go into the hands of a private shareholder instead of further into the industry and being recycled. So the benefit is across the UK creative economy. The benefit is also, of course, in those 10,000 young people or a quarter of a million young people that we would train. If we were sold and reached a price of between 500 million and 1 billion, depending on the conditions put on the sale, we spend more than 700 million every year in the UK economy. So you're at about 1.2 or 1.3 years till that's evened. So my concern is that, you know, and people say it's an odd concern given I've worked in private business. My concern is that we just apply proper legislative scrutiny to this, because I think the consequences may be unintended, but they're certainly not unforeseeable. I think we must, all of us, just think through what the impact assessment is, what legislative scrutiny is required, ensure that there's enough time to discuss and debate such an action, because we are a critical part of the UK's creative economy. And you've heard certainly of the output on screen, and you've heard about our work in young people, with young people, and our work in terms of levelling up. And you can probably see that we all believe in that and we're quite excited about it. And I just think we need to think through, as an industry, what is the impact and what is the scrutiny that requires to make sure that we don't do anything that in 5 years will be regrettable.
Final question. Points very well made there. Have you spoken to Nadine Dorries about this, and will you invite her to your Glasgow hub?
I will always invite the Secretary of State to all things. And, you know, the support of the DCMS is very, very important to us, and I'm sure they very much believe in our levelling up mission.
But have you spoken to Nadine Dorries about this?
Absolutely. We're in good dialogue with the DCMS, and obviously we pitched very hard to them about our levelling up plan for the next episode.
OK. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Ms Mahon, Ms Street, Ms Robinson, thank you very much for your attendance at committee this morning. Particularly, Alex, I've enjoyed having a BAFTA in the room. We don't normally experience that in the Scottish Parliament. But thank you very much for your attendance this morning. I'm suspending for 5 minutes and we'll return for our final session this morning. Thanks. Thank you. A warm welcome back. And our next item of business is agenda item 3 on Scotland Census. And from the National Registers of Scotland, I welcome to committee Paul Rowe, Register General and Chief Executive, Peter Whitehouse, Director of Statistical Services, and Anne Slater, Director of Operations and Deputy Registrar General. And invite the Registrar to make a very brief opening statement. Thanks. Mr. Lowe, available?
Thank you. Sorry, I was just waiting for my mic to be unmuted. So, good morning. Thank you, convener, and good morning, committee. Scotland Census is a highly complex programme, and in combination with many other modern censuses, consists of a number of different elements. It brings together high-quality census returns, coverage survey, peer-reviewed statistical techniques, and use of high-quality administrative data to provide additional quality assurance. Our approach to delivering the census was informed by stakeholder engagement, work with other census-taking bodies and user research. Our responsibilities were to implement the legislation and put in place the tools and support to enable citizens to meet their personal legal obligation to complete their census. 2022 census provided more options and greater flexibility to complete the census than had been available before, whether online, paper or assisted completion. Over 2 million households, or 89% of respondents, selected the online route, showing a clear public preference for this approach. However, paper questionnaires were widely available, and during the course of the census, more than 600,000 were issued. In advance of this session, we provided the committee with some facts and figures about the activities from Scotland Census. I think these demonstrate the phenomenal effort of census staff to support the public to complete their census. I'd like to thank everyone involved in delivering the census and the many organisations and individuals who have engaged with us. As you're aware, the Cabinet Secretary announced to Parliament on 28th of April that the census collection would be extended by 1 month to provide an additional opportunity for households who had not yet done so to complete their returns. On the 31st of May, the public awareness campaign came to an end and our field operations ceased. In line with practice in other UK censuses, we continue to accept late returns for a short period afterwards. As at yesterday, the national return rate was 89%, with more than 2.3 million household returns. The month-long extension to the collection period has had a very positive impact on return rates, with the national return rate increasing by 9.8 percentage points since the 1st of May, 30 out of 32 local authorities meeting the NRS 85% local authority response target, where there was only one at the 1st of May, and indeed 18 local authorities meeting or exceeding 90%. The most notable difference was in Glasgow, where the return rate had increased by 12.4 percentage points. I do regret that we were not able to quite secure the 90% or better that we have advised your predecessor committee. It is clear that there have been issues with lower returns than in 2011, and it's important to understand the reasons for this and what this means for future census exercises. However, at 89%, we are very close to what we set out to achieve. My international panel of experts have confirmed we have a solid foundation to move to the next phase, and that is what we are now doing. Census coverage survey, which is the second largest social survey undertaken in Scotland, is now underway. The CCS has been used in the last two censuses in Scotland, and it is critical to understand who has been missed by the census collection and allows our statisticians to estimate for both the volume and characteristics of those people and households missing from the census. It underpins, as part of other measures, the production of high-quality estimates of the size and structure of Scotland's population. I look forward to answering your questions today. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Perhaps I could open Mr. Lowe with the census work is not yet complete, although the deadline has gone. Can you give us a bit of background on what remains to be done and possible timescales for when we might have a report back on the learning points from this year's census?
Okay, thank you for that. Yeah, the next phase, as you say, is the census coverage survey, which is getting underway at the moment and will run until the end of July or early August. The survey, doorstep survey of approximately 50,000 households, so that process is underway at the moment. We are continuing as part of a program to gather lessons learned. In common with previous censuses, we will prepare an evaluation of the census that will go to the Parliament. That will usually be produced after the first output results from the census are achieved. So that will probably be in 2023, but we'll obviously be happy to keep the committee up to date with learnings and other information that we gather in the intervening time.
Thank you. Can I move to questions from committee? Can I invite first Ms. Boyack?
Thank you very much. Very useful to get the paper in evidence. Can I ask you a couple of questions about the timing? I understand that almost a third of the population, when asked, weren't aware of the census, and particularly given the change of timing, to look at the digital issue. My understanding is that in the rest of the UK, when the 2021 census was carried out, there was a safety net approach to try and include people. You made a big deal of the digital response rate, but to have to send out 600,000 paper versions, you know, not going for the safety net approach to target areas where you would have lower income households, disproportionately older population, and also rural areas. So can you give us a bit of a comment about that? And also can you give us comparable stats on local authority turnouts in terms of households and in terms of individuals? Because I'm just making sure that the data we've got is comparable in terms of local authority turnouts, and particularly how you're going to go below the local authority level and to make sure people don't miss out, who either didn't respond to the census or disproportionately areas. And will you be producing evidence or analysing the census output areas so that we get accurate knowledge about who's missed out in the census?
Thank you for that. I think three questions there, so just to sort of pick them up in turn. The first one on the information you quoted, that was based on a survey of people at the end of the census who had not completed the census. So it wasn't a general survey of the population to assess their understanding or awareness. Sorry, I just wanted to clarify that point. Obviously, the largest group of people reported that they were too busy or just didn't have the time to do the census. That was 35% of responses, and then there were other reasons stated. So that there clearly are a number of issues in terms of why people in that kind of final group who didn't participate didn't return their response, and we need to kind of understand that. There will obviously be things that we as a census taking organisation can take into account and build into the future design of the census and the lessons that we learn from this. But I do think this also flags some potential changes in public attitude and societal attitude, which will also require close thought for how censuses are launched and run in the future. In terms of your point on ONS, you're absolutely right that at the very start of the census, ONS issued some paper forms that were targeted. We didn't do that, but from the 28th of February, we had a capability for people to request paper forms, well in advance of census day on the 20th of March. And we received in excess of 360,000 requests for paper forms through that route alone. We did, however, issue proactive forms, taking into account some of the circumstances that you're talking about, digital exclusion and various other factors, and we issued over 115,000 forms proactively to that group. Now, that wasn't on day one, that was some weeks later. And our field teams also issued forms. They issued about 92,000 forms. Now, some of those were forms posted through doors where there weren't responses. Some of them were because householders requested the forms. I think one of the biggest enigmas in this is that of the 600,000 forms that we issued, we've received less than half of them back. And even if we just were to focus in on the 363,000 that were requested, that actually somebody proactively got in touch with us and said, can I have a form, please? Only about two-thirds of those were returned to us. on the final point about sub-local authority data, I'll hand you over to Pete Whitehouse, our chief statistician, to give you a bit more information on that.
Morning, everybody. Hopefully you can all hear me. Okay, so the question, as I understood it, was around return rates, local authority, and below that. So thank you for that question. What we've presented at various points through the programme and continue to do today and provide to the committee has been at local authority and national return rates. So we have a population. So we have a household register at which we send out forms and invitations to take part in the census, and it is against that and the work that our field force are doing to make sure that we are gathering all the households that are in scope, so that we're not including, for example, vacant properties or businesses, or that we are picking up, say, conversions where flats or houses have been changed in the nature and the size of and the number of homes that are within that location. So we do a lot of work to understand our household group are, and that is what we report on. So it's the return rates, the responses that we've gathered from the households. What we are then doing, and as I say, that is at local authority level that we present those figures. What we then do is, as Paul has mentioned, is that we carry out and are carrying out at this moment this census coverage survey, which all the census bodies across the UK have been using as a statistical tool since 2001. And what that allows us to do is get a good understanding of the households or the types of areas where returns have been lower than we were than we were looking for. So helping us to understand any gaps in the census data. We will then also add into that our administrative data that we are continuing to develop and evolve, and many people on the committee will be fully aware of how administrative data is now a much more fuller part of the analytical base of statistics across all dimensions of the economy and society. We are working there with colleagues across the UK, but also very particularly within Scotland, to make sure that we get use of all of that information. So, for example, knowing from the population, from the pupil census, the number of school-aged children roughly that are in a particular area helps us understand how many the census should be covering. And if we don't see some of those figures, we know that we need to use some statistical techniques to make sure that we cover that. So the technique is gathering the information from the returns from the households, using the census coverage survey to understand where we need to make adjustments, using administrative data to help us with those adjustments and any biases that may be in the data. And then what we do, and this sort of get to the end of the answer, is we present our outputs, our census, our statistical estimates, and it's these things that will be presented in at census output areas and our low area geographies, and that will be our estimate of the population size and characteristics. And as you aggregate those areas, you get more and more detail, and that's another area where about protecting confidentiality and privacy. So the smaller the area that you look at, the less data you get, and so you'll get population estimates. As we aggregate all of that, you start to get much more of the richness. Hopefully that's answered the question. Thank you.
Doesn't quite answer the question, because what I was asking was the comparable figures from local authority level data from the 2022 census and the 2011 census. I'm particularly interested in that in terms of credibility, because I've looked at the statistics and I just wanted to double check that my interpretation was right, because the gap is quite significant. You know, Western Bartonshire, 11% down from 2011, but I want to check that I'm using the right figures in terms of households and individual responses. And I do want to go back to that information about people not knowing either about the census or their personal responsibilities, because it's even more of an impact, you know, if it's several weeks into the census programme that a third of the population were still not aware both of their obligations or the impact of the census. So I think all that goes back to the credibility of the 2022 census, given the aspirations to hit around 94%. You know, what does that do for the effectiveness and the usefulness of this year's census?
Shall I? Yeah. I'll just come back and then Paul wants to add. So at the moment, the data we have on 2022 is household returns. You may have in front of you the population returns. We don't have the 2011 stuff. I don't have that to hand. But the comparison to be made, and we will do that later on in the process, can be made between the individual population returns and from 2022 and 2011. But what we have at this point in time is the household returns. Comparisons, the point that I would also make around that is that the census is not and is increasingly not just an administrative count. So in 1991, the census was run as an administrative count, and what we got is what we got. And what we understand is that we probably, there was an undercount of the population. What we have done since 2001, and this is the work that ONS and NISRA also do, and other global censuses, organisations across the globe, is that we take those census returns. We have done lots of work, particularly during the extension, to make sure that coverage is as across Scotland and in all the communities as we can. And then we do our census coverage survey and our administrative data work. So it is the combination of data. So comparisons between return rates from 2022 to 2011 or earlier are of some use for sure, and they are of interest, but they aren't the sole measure of the quality of the census outputs, because what we are trying to do is build on our census returns, add in the knowledge that we get from our census coverage survey, add in administrative data, and use that to produce the high quality census outputs. And it is those pieces of evidence that we will be bringing together. And that's where we're getting the advice from our international steering group around different statistical methodologies and how we maximize that. The question about awareness of the census, as Paul says, the information that was gathered by field force on the doorstep as they were seeking final completion. And that information, so it's not of the population in entirety, it is of the people who at that point, right at the end of the census, hadn't yet managed to complete a census. And of those, a third of them said they were too busy at that point. So we know, as I said, you know, we've had 2.32 million returns. You know, that is a very significant amount of the population knowing. But as I say, it's not just the census returns, it's all the other valuable work that we add in. And this is what happens across all censuses now that run that kind of modern approach to gathering the data. And I'll just finish. So in terms of our presentation of our outputs, we will produce high quality population estimates bounded by our statistical confidence around those to allow users to understand the variability in that. And that will also be how we present all of our other data.
Okay, so there's not an issue about the credibility of this census in your view. I suppose it's because I went out and visited with your enumerators and I was so struck by the fact that it was a very significant area I was in, and just under 2 weeks to go, there was a turnout rate of 57%, and it just didn't tick the box off 94% And it's just how those missing households and missing people are going to be accounted for so that their needs are not ignored by future investment or government policy. I think I come away with that, even with today's answers, with quite significant worries.
So if I think Paul is coming off.
I was very grateful to you for actually coming out and seeing the experience of Field Force staff. I can entirely appreciate the concern, which I know you've illuminated in other places as well. I mean, what I would say is that the census coverage survey goes out to some of those same places and gathers information, and its purpose is to fill in the gaps where people haven't responded. So the first thing I would say is that the extension period increased the response rate across Glasgow by 12.4 percentage points. We focused a lot of our effort, our field teams, we put additional people into Glasgow and additional focus over that 4 weeks, particularly to target the places that had the lowest response rates and bring them up. I could have done a very cynical exercise where I could have sent Field Force staff out to low-hanging fruit areas across the country and got myself 92% response rate, but it wouldn't have been a good quality census because I wouldn't have good quality data about the communities and the areas that you're quite rightly concerned about. That's not what we did here. What we did is we picked the areas where we had the lowest response rates, where we needed to know more. We targeted our focus and resource into those areas to drive up the response rates, gather more data, and if you look at the shift in response rates, you'll see that they're the most significant in places like Glasgow, Dundee, and other places where deprivation are factors. That because that's the approach that we took. Now, I agree that still means that there's some differences between what was achieved in 2011, but in 2011 there was also variability in different parts of the country. But the census coverage survey and the additional data and the work that Pete's talked about is very much used to address those gaps and those issues. So we do not see any issues with the credibility of where we are at the moment. I understand the public interest in this, which is why I brought together an international expert panel of individuals to look at what we'd done. You know, so we had a number of sessions where we presented what had been achieved, what we were doing, how we'd done it, where we got to, and what we were planning to do next. And in their public, you know, I saw that as an important bit of independent assurance to anyone who did have concern on this issue. And they very much said we have a solid foundation and that it was right for us to move on the census coverage survey, which is what we've done. On the final point about lack of awareness, we've all picked up on the point that this was gathering views from people at the very tail end, the last week of the census. It wasn't a few weeks in and people hadn't responded. But I think we also have to remember that everybody in the country received a letter on how to take part. 2.7 million letters were issued. It wasn't some digital or email approach. Everyone received physical letter around the 28th of February. And for people who didn't respond, there were then up to 5 reminder letters that were put through the doors. There were hundreds of television adverts and thousands of social media adverts and physical advertising. There was work with a range of different partners, local government and others, who also put out communications across their areas and the different groups that they work in. So there was a very extensive campaign to reach it. Now, it's always difficult to exactly measure reach, but the communications industry do have measures for this, and they anticipate that in the first phase of our marketing campaign, which was the first 5 weeks of the census, approximately 98% of the population had access to a minimum of at least 6 advertised messages about the census. So I don't think this is an issue about lack of public awareness. I think people were reached in a range of different ways in combination.
Going to move on to Mr. Cameron.
Thank you. Thank you very much, convener, and morning to the panel. Just like to ask you about the target, because there was mention this morning and in your letter to us of yesterday about a suggestion that 90% was the target or or thereabouts. Would you accept that in the November 2019 document, from which one of the KPIs you cite comes, you defined as an overarching definition of success a person response rate of at least 94%? And further, that I think you referenced an evidence session in September 2020 to our predecessor committee. And in that, Mr. Whitehouse did mention the figure of 90%, but he went on to talk about the 2011 figure of 94% gives us, and I quote, what we are aiming for, and also went on to talk about a good mid-90s response. So do you accept that as a target, both in evidence to the Parliament and on paper, 94% was where you were aiming for? I ask Mr. Lowe and Mr. Whitehouse.
Thank you, Mr. Cameron. Yeah, I mean, what I would say is that there's a document that quotes that figure. That figure somewhat predates my arrival in the organisation, but it's based on replicating the response rate in 2011. It is not based on an assessment that if the organisation or Scotland's people fail to return 94%, that the census suddenly becomes worthless. Because it's not an either or argument. I think the Cabinet Secretary, Ms. Hislop, at the time, and in our evidence, is saying we articulated that we were looking for something of 90% plus. We will always want to get as high a rate as we can because that improves quality of the data. But we are not in a position at 89% at the moment where we do not have a credible response and more than sufficient data. And I think it's very challenging territory to suggest that when over 2.32 million Scottish households have responded to the census, that census data is of no worth or no value.
Do you not think it reasonable to expect a response rate in 2022 of at least the response rate you achieved in 2011, though?
No, not necessarily. So if you look at the 2001 census, it was 96%. So there was a 2% reduction in response rate in the following census. So there is fluctuation around response rates. It can't necessarily be expected that you will always replicate the same rate in the census before.
Can I turn to Mr. Whitehouse, given you said in September 2020, that 94% gives us what we are aiming for, and you then spoke about a good mid-90s response. And do you stand by those comments?
Okay, I'm waiting for my mic. Okay, so the conversation, as I remember, the evidence was around the context of where we might be if we were trying to deliver in 2021. So there were conversations with committee and elsewhere about our concern that we would be in the 60s and 70s% return. So my language around 90 was a broad message that that's where we want to be. The performance indicator was set as a program performance indicator on the basis of that's where what was achieved in 2011. But what is absolutely clear and perhaps absolutely put my hands up, I could have been clearer at the time, is that this is about getting as much census returns as possible within a reasonable time frame that then allows us to move forward, add the data that we are gathering for the census coverage survey, add the administrative data, innovate and add our statistical estimation methodology and produce bounded estimates, statistical estimates about the characteristics and numbers of the Scottish population. The key performance indicator, it is perhaps unfortunate that there is a focus on one of those as opposed to the fact that there is also one around an 85% threshold, which, as Paul set out at the beginning, we have over half of the local authorities are above 90%, 30 are above 85%, And with, I think, Glasgow being at the lowest, which is just under that. But it, so in terms of that indicator, we are in a good place. I'm confident that with the census coverage survey and the administrative data and our statistical methodology, we will deliver those bounded, high-quality census outputs that we're all driving to achieve.
Thank you for those answers. Can I turn to the question of the safety net that Sarah Boyack was asking you about? Because I think this is an important distinction between what happened in England and Wales and Scotland. In England and Wales, as we've heard, where the take-up of online sort of completion was expected to be low, i.e. in digitally excluded areas, of areas of deprivation, rural areas where there was perhaps a disproportionately high elderly population, the ONS sent paper copies out at the outset, and I think they sent them to about 10% of households, of whom half responded by filling out the paper copy. In Scotland, that was not done. And given the eventual return rates, do you accept that that was an error? And I'll ask Paul Lowe, followed by Pete Whitehouse, please.
Thank you for that question. I think the issue here is that there was an issue of timing and that we did it a few weeks later than ONS. There isn't any evidence to support the assertion that that was critical difference. We'll obviously see if we can determine and learn lessons from it. It is a difference, but equally in Scotland, we issued considerably more reminders to people than happened in ONS. So there are a number of differences in design and approach. So some things that we did earlier or we did in higher quantities or more frequently, and things that the ONS did. But as I said, we did issue large quantities of proactive forms to that group of people well within the timescale for people to respond to this census. But certainly we will look at the effectiveness of what ONS did as part of our lessons learned process.
And Mr. Whitehouse?
I'm not sure I have anything further to add to what Paul has said.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Ms. Mintle?
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, panel. I've just got a very quick question. Mr. Lowe, you have twice referenced a solid foundation with regards to the census results. As I'm a lay person, can you explain what that means, what that message from the International Steering Group actually means?
Yeah, as we'd articulated in evidence to the predecessor committee around the decision to delay the census due to COVID, we anticipated that we would achieve some response rates somewhere in the 60 or 70% range, which we assessed as far too low to provide a credible census return. So we have an understanding of where a credible return, which we can then, you know, take and use other elements, versus something which would not render something of the quality of a census. So our sense is that we were looking to deliver a census with a response rate of 90% plus and to get as high as we could. We have ended up at 89%. Our internal assessment as an organisation is that that is a very high level of response. I think anyone would struggle to think of any other sort of exercise of public engagement where you're getting that level of response rate. But because of the scale of the public debate and some of the criticisms about the census response rate in Scotland, I thought it was important to provide additional reassurance. It wasn't just our advice or being seen that we were marking our own homework, but that actually we brought in some very credible worldwide experts on census and coverage surveys to look at where we got to with the census. And they could have come back and said the census return rate was inadequate. You should continue to keep collecting census data. So the quote that you reference is from Professor James Brown, who's a professor of official statistics in Sydney, who's the chair of the panel, but was endorsed by other panel members, which is that we have reached a reasonable, sensible, credible point to stop the census collection and move on to the next phase of the census. So that's essentially what it's trying to capture.
Okay, so basically, if I understand what you're saying that the level of returns and the information that will be able to be gathered from the census returns is a suitable level for the decisions that are required to be made by the census to be made.
Absolutely correct, yes.
Thank you.
Mr. Simpson?
Thanks very much, Convener. Mr. Lowe, let's see if I just pick you up correctly. You said when you were considering whether to go ahead in 2021 or not, you expected, if you had gone ahead, that you would get a return rate of 60 to 70%. Am I correct in that? Yeah, you're nodding. Okay.
Yeah.
And of course, the census did go ahead in the rest of the UK and was more successful than the Scottish census has been, which was delayed by a year. So you got that wrong, didn't you?
No, because that's comparing two different things. So the context of the evidence to the committee that I'm referring to was in relation to the fact that in Scotland there were a number of different circumstances that existed which would have resulted in significant changes being made to the census design, which would have resulted in a lower response rate. So what was happening, if you recall, in 2020 with the pandemic at the time, was that we didn't have mass testing, we didn't have clarity on when we were going to get a vaccine. Our colleagues in the United States were running a census that during the pandemic that had run into considerable difficulties, and they had to extend their collection period they had to double it. And other events were obviously being rescheduled, including the local government elections at that time. So the census isn't something that you can take a decision a day or two before that you cancel it. You either take a decision to run it or you take a decision to reschedule it, and you have to do that far in advance. So we were having to take some decisions based on the evidence and information that was available to us at the time. The ONS were also undertaking similar considerations, but their circumstances were different, so that they estimated that if they were to reschedule their census by a year, it would cost £365 million, which was about 39% of their total programme costs. They also, as the National Statistics Institute, had a resource of 6,000 people and a budget of close to £1 billion in which to kind of manage the additional pressures and issues that resulted from the pandemic. And the final element that was relevant to them is that independently they had been working for many years on the development of administrative data. Now, that was related to their wider functions as in economic and social survey statistics. But as the COVID pandemic hit, they started to look at how they could use that data, that if they encountered a situation with low response rates, that they could mitigate that by using those administrative data resources. Now, in Scotland, and as confirmed by the Chief Statistician for Scotland, that data wasn't available. So each organisation was looking at this based on a risk-based decision. And there were a number of things that were different in the situation in England with ONS than were the case in Scotland. In Scotland, we could not have run the census. We had exhausted our contingency time. We were dealing with other demands, including the production of COVID statistics and also moving resource to deal with the radical changes being made to the registration system at Scotland at the time of the pandemic. If you maybe recall, there was huge concern about the ability to manage and register the deaths of people from COVID at that time. I'm responsible for the death registration system. ONS are not responsible for the death registration system in England. So I had to pivot resources and people to deal with those tasks, and I didn't have a 6,000 strong organisation that I could just borrow additional people from to do that. So choices had to be made around priorities and what could and couldn't be delivered at that time.
Okay, so you're saying it was impossible for you to have run the census in 2021? Impossible. Who took that decision? Was it yourself or was it ministers?
Well, ultimately it was ministers. So to clarify that process, what we did is we undertook a detailed impact assessment analysis of the threats and risks to COVID to the delivery of the census programme. Having undertaken that exercise, and we published a summary of the results back in 2020, we reached the conclusion that we could not deliver the census as conceived for March 2021. We didn't have the time or the people left in order to do that and deliver it in a different way. There were also a set of circumstances about the public response and reaction to the possibility of gathering the census data at the time of Scotland being in lockdown. And again, if you'll recall, in March 2021, Scotland was still in lockdown. England and Wales had come out of lockdown. So there were differences in the restrictions. We did look at alternative options to deliver the census, which would have maintained the date. These involved an all-paper approach, using an online approach only, using both but without a field force. But our conclusion of all of those is that we would have seen a massively significantly reduced response rate. There's obviously questions today about concerns about getting to 89% and how and is that good enough or what does that mean? We would have been in a position with a considerably lower response rate in Scotland than anything we've achieved at this time. And to be honest, there would have been real credibility issues about the nature of the census data gathered at that time. So we were taking decisions based on the information available at the time, the risks that existed, the fact that there were differences between Scotland and England and Wales as part of that risk-based decision-making, and also recognising that censuses are extremely costly to cancel at the 11th hour, and also extremely costly to run a follow-up census if the results aren't achieved.
I'm aware that other members will want in, convener, but the were concerns raised at the time when the decision was taken to delay for a year. Various experts, I don't need to list them, but you'll know who they are, came out and said, you know, this could have an impact. Indeed, that appears to have been the case. So I'm just wondering, and we always speak about lessons learned, do you think moving ahead that Scotland's census and the UK, the rest of the UK census, could get back into lockstep next time round?
Yeah, thanks very much for the question. I mean, just to sort of clarify, this wasn't a political decision. This was an analysis undertaken by NRS as a census-taking organisation based on the threat to the delivery of the census in Scotland for all of the reasons that we've talked about. So we made those recommendations to ministers and ministers agreed them, but it wasn't ministers asking us to delay the census by a year. So it's ultimately a decision for the Parliament as to when the next census is taken. But we have to reflect that the census has only been moved out a step twice in its 200 plus year history, one of them for World War II and then in Scotland for the pandemic. I would also sort of say I appreciate and understand entirely why comparisons are being made by what happened in England and Wales. But we have to remember that 71% of the countries in the world who were planning to take a census in 2020 and 2021 delayed it. And that included Ireland, it included Germany, it included Italy. So it wasn't an unusual decision that was taken here. It was a decision that many nations across the world, including Western democracies, were taking at that very same time for that very same reason.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. Dr. Allen?
Thank you. On that point, I wonder, firstly a hypothetical question, I suppose, but based on what you've been talking about there, if the decision had been taken to go ahead with a census at the very low point or high point, however you want to look at it, of the restrictions around the pandemic, you've indicated how difficult it would be from a practical point of view to organise that, but would it also have created some very strange data for historians looking back as well?
Thank you. That's a very insightful question. Yeah, this is one of the purposes of the census is to gather data that asks the same questions of people at the same time, but is also reflective of society as it exists at that, you know, and is then usable in future years. So one of the challenges, and obviously a source of some criticism by some academics of censuses that took place during pandemics, was that they gathered data at an unusual point in society. Now, on one hand, people can say, well, it's really helpful to get data about that really unusual thing that happened. On the other hand, others will say, well, but that's not representative of society. It's representative of society in a lockdown or a near lockdown position. So you do get into difficulties because, for example, students aren't in the same place that they would be normally. You know, if I was to take a census in 2021, you know, the population of St Andrews would look and feel very different. People were working at home, so that the data that you get in relation to where people work, how they travel, how they get there, that informs transport decisions and other decisions, is skewed. And certainly, I know our colleagues in ONS, one of the things that they've had to do, and they're a hugely capable organisation, and they've done it, is to make adjustments for the fact that the population weren't in the same places doing exactly the same things during the pandemic in 2021.
Thank you. My other question, convener, was about household visits. I see in the data that you've provided suggests that there were over 1.5 million household visits across the country by field staff. Can you maybe just explain for us what a household visit constitutes? I mean, for instance, in my own local authority area, suggests that over half the households had such a visit. So what did that constitute?
Thanks. I'll perhaps just hand over in a second to Anne, who's our operations director and kind of manage the field teams. But yeah, 1.7 million address visits were undertaken. So that could have covered situations where people weren't in at the time. But Anne can talk about the protocols and what was done under those circumstances. And hand over to Anne.
Thank you, Paul. I hope everybody can hear me, but let me know if you can't. So our field force would get a note of the addresses that they were to visit on a daily basis, and a household visit would mean that the field force person would go to the household and you know, attempt to make contact with whoever was living there. If they did make contact, then they would you know talk to them about the census and the different ways that can be completed, and certainly in the first. In before the extension period, they were directed to contact our contact centre if there were issues, and to do telephone data capture to assist digital. They would offer the householder a paper form if they have one. They would make sure that they knew how to complete the census online. So they were making sure that the householder was aware of all the channels, and also exploring with the householder if there were any barriers to completion and what else that they could do to help them. So in some instance, the householder would complete the paper questionnaire, and the field person would arrange to go back the next day and collect it for them and post them and all sorts of things like that. If the householder was not in when the field person made contact or rang the doorbell or whatever, then they would put a calling card through the door that had some information about the census on it, and the phone number for our contact centre if they needed further help. But we had a system that recorded, you know, if there'd been no contact made, so that address would then come back and to be subsequently enumerated. Hence, as I think mentioned in other explanations, that often householders had more than one visit. certainly in the first instance, there was roughly about 70% contact, 70% non-contact rather, and 30% contact. And that dropped slightly when we moved into May, I think, you know, possibly as a result of better weather and things, and often more people are out. I hope that gives you everything you need to know. Thank you.
I'm just going to go online for a final question, conscious of time though. Is Mr. Ruskell wanting to ask a question?
Yeah, thanks. I appreciate the technical nature of the evidence this morning. And as you're saying, it was a technical decision to delay rather than a political one. I think most of my questionnaires have already been answered, convener, but I did want to just pick up on one thing that I think Paul Lowe alluded to earlier on, and that was just around perhaps changing attitudes within society towards these kind of censuses. I don't know if you could expand on that. Did I pick you up correctly that there may be a changing attitude at all?
Yeah, I mean, I have to be careful that some of this is understanding of other data that out with the census, but probably do have to reflect that there are a significant number of events that have happened in the last year or two. We've had over 2 years of people living under very considerable COVID restrictions and having to follow government guidance and government rules and instructions. That there's some data out there that sort of suggests that that's starting to shift society's attitudes and how they interact with government and officialdom. There's also kind of information that, you know, people are currently or recently distracted by a number of different things happening in their life. You know, the post-Brexit landscape, what's happening in the cost of living crisis and various other things. So as going back to that survey, that survey was based on 1,213 households who agreed to answer in the last week of the census, and 35% of those people just said that they were too busy to do the census. And certainly that also chimes with some of the feedback that we were getting at the doorstep. People didn't see the census as important enough to them to do, or that they would do it, but they would do it at a later time, but that later time never came. And we changed the design of the census as we ran, because we saw this starting to happen. We ended up issuing 5 reminder letters to people who didn't respond. We were originally planning, and ONS, I believe too, we were planning to issue a couple of reminder letters. We added in 3 additional layers of reminder letters, and we had to extend and add in additional advertising activity that we hadn't planned to do, and in particular, you know, our colleagues in ONS hadn't had to run with. So there are a range of things we had to build in to try and deal with the fact that we weren't getting the response rates we expected. But I'm highly surprised at the high proportion of people, about a third, who phoned up or contacted us to request a paper form, who then didn't return it. You know, those are people who are very proactive in requesting one, but then didn't send them back for whatever reason. So I think there are some really fundamental questions that might not just inform future censuses, but indeed future engagements with the public on a range of different policy issues and how we do that in the future. Hope that helps.
If you were to sum it up in one word, would you say it was a sense of, you know, fatigue?
I think there's certainly an element of that at play here, yes.
Yeah, thanks, Camille.
Thank you. Mr. Lowe, can I thank you and your officials this morning for attending the session. I'm going to quickly close as we have a further agenda item in private. Thank you very much.